The first one under the presidentship of Dr. Selvaraj, second from OSS. Today we are having the theme based on musculoskeletal oncology. Before we start on with the program, I would like to introduce our digital streaming partners, ClearNet. They have a small presentation to make. Now I request them to play their presentation. Debulina?
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. So I'm Debulina on behalf of ClearNet. ClearNet is India's largest live digital CME and doctor-generated medical content platform. So here is a short glimpse of ClearNet. All for your patience. You can always find us on Google, www.clearnet.com, and experience our various services. So thank you all. Over to Bharat, sir.
Thank you, Debulina. We also thank you for the streaming provided today. And we'll start off with the welcome address by our president of OSS, Dr. Selvaraj. Selvaraj, sir.
Yeah. Very good evening to everyone here. My dear dynamic and enthusiastic Secretary General of OASIS, Anin, Dr. Nityananda Rao, the Vice President of OASIS from Karnataka, Dr. Chandrasekhar, President of KOA, and the dynamic Dr. Raju, Bharat Raju, the Secretary General of KOA, the coordinators of this ICL, Dr. Srimant and Dr. Suman, the faculty, and the dear participants. It's a pleasant duty and a privilege and a honor to be a part of this first program in my presidentship. I took over a few days back, and within almost 10 days, I get the opportunity to chair and be a part of the musculoskeletal oncology basics and beyond. Musculoskeletal oncology has always been a tough branch, because I've been working with Dr. Mail for almost 2 decades, and I know how difficult it is, especially when you get patients in a late stage. They go to this native treatment, this and that, and come to you very late. And decision making and giving them a proper paka cure is always a challenge to the orthopedic surgeon. I'm sure the faculty here will enlighten the younger as well as the experienced orthopedic surgeons in this group on how to go about when you get a case of a tumor, and this will be a very useful ICL. Thank you very much, KOA, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your kind words. Now I request Professor Anin N. Kutty, the Secretary General of OSS, to say a few words. So your mic is muted, sir.
Okay. Respected OASIS President, Selvaraj sir, Nityananda Rao sir, Senior Vice President, KOA President Chandrasekhar sir, Bharat, and the coordinators, Srimant and Suman, and all the delegates. Good evening, and I think we have started this ICL in a mission to give you every month one topic, so that it's a continuous program, and you need not worry. It is on the first Tuesday. I think it's just clicking up when we have bigger intentions. But Bharat will be of making it a bigger program. But definitely the junior orthopedic surgeons, definitely oncology is a good topic because it's an ever... We are all uncertain about the newer trends, and I think Suman and Seaman are good people to guide us through the musculoskeletal oncology, the recent trends, and the basics also. I've told all the postgraduates to enter the CME. This should be a platform for all the postgraduates, especially those people who are doing their DNBs in busy hospitals where much of teaching is not there. So that is our intention also. So thank you, KOA, for taking this up, and the coordinators also. I hope this CME goes well, and all the best wishes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I request Senior Vice President of OSS, Dr. Nityanand Rao, to say a few words.
Yeah, and thank you, Dr. Bharat. This ICR is a great initiative which is started by Dr. Raghav Dutt and Dr. Anin. And I'm sure that Dr. Selva and Dr. Anin now will take it to greater heights. This has given a great impetus to OSS, especially the teaching program for the postgraduates. It is my joy that my parent organization, Karnataka Orthopedic Association, is hosting this evening's program. And with the help of our dynamic president, Dr. Chandrasekhar, who is the director of Sanjay Gandhi Hospital for Trauma, and Dr. Bharat, a professor in KIMS. So I welcome all the vice presidents of OSS, EC of OSS, all the president and secretaries of all the six state associations, all the faculty of this evening's special welcome to you all. And my sincere thanks to Dr. Sriman for taking all the trouble to go ahead and conduct this. And of course, I welcome the participants and hope we'll be able to take a lot of tips and tricks in the diagnosis of oncology. So with this welcome, I request Dr. Bharat to go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Chandrasekhar, President of Karnataka Orthopedics Association, to deliver his presidential address.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I welcome all our OSS members and KOA members for this academic activity. I appreciate the efforts of our President, Dr. Sharma, and Dr. Kutty, Secretary General of OSS, for an effort to take forward the OSS activities that to involve all the states of OSS. The kind of webinars will not only educate the audience, but also improve the relationship between the orthopedic surgeons of all South India, all the six states. We'll all get to know each other better, keep us all united like a family. On behalf of KOA, I thank Dr. Nityananda. I think he is going to be president next from Karnataka. Right now, he's the vice president for organizing this ICR on orthopedic oncology. And special thanks to Bharat for coordinating this webinar. I think we are conducting next ICL in April 2022. Today, I welcome all the leading orthopedic oncologists from various reputed centers of South India. I think they are all going to talk on basic concept principles in the management of bone tumors, followed by case discussions. Wish all the best to our moderators, Dr. Sumant and Dr. Srimant, conducting the program. I think they are going to conduct this program very successfully without any delay. I hand over the program to our moderator, Dr. Sriman, to conduct this program and also to introduce the speakers to the audience. I am sure our audience will learn a lot and they will improve their technique to do onco-orthopedic surgery. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chandrasekhar, sir. Now, I think we'll hand over to Dr. Srimant and Dr. Suman. Srimant, I think you can take over and take the program ahead.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the platform. In fact, gratitude to the office bearers of OSS and Karnataka Orthopedic Association for this opportunity. So just to go through the program, I'll be just sharing the outline. Yeah, so we have a good cast today. So myself and Dr. Suman, who's another considered orthopedic oncosurgeon from Bangalore itself, will be taking you all across the program. Our faculty is consisted of senior surgeons and contemporaries, Dr. Srinivas, Dr. Pramod, Dr. Kishore Reddy, and also Dr. Rajiv, Dr. Navneet, and Dr. Vishwanamarajam. All of them are logged in. We'll be taking you through the basics, literally the basics of trying to find out how we identify a bone tumor, how do we do a biopsy, when we do a biopsy, when we get a diagnosis, how do we treat them? So if so, what are the principles? And in case of malignancy, in case of benign, how do we go across? And once this basic set is done, we are actually having a comprehensive case discussion with our stellar faculty, where we'll be discussing right from the benigns up to the malignant soft tissues and the bone metastasis in the time period given to us. So just to start with, I'll be requesting Dr. Navneet Kamath to share his views on how we try to spot a bone tumor.
Srimant, can you just introduce the speakers once? Briefly.
Yeah, so let me just go back to the slide again. Is my screen visible, sir, again? Yeah. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is
visible. So, myself, I'm Dr. Sriman B.S. I'm a considered orthopedic oncosurgeon practicing at Apollo in Bengaluru. And Dr. Suman, who's my co-coordinator, he's a considered surgeon at Narayana Health City in Bangalore. We have senior faculties, Dr. Srinivas, who's the CEO of Prakriya Hospital, and he practices orthopedic oncology and also is running the show at one of the premier centers. Dr. Pramod Chinder, again, is another senior consultant who's been in Bangalore for quite some time, and he's taking care of orthopedic oncology services as a director in HCG Hospital. Dr. Kishore Reddy has joined us from Hyderabad, where he's been a senior consultant at American Oncology Institute, and also has a large team of orthopedic service providers also. So comprehensive management for orthopedic and non-orthopedic oncology is done by him. Dr. Vishnu Ramanujam is another senior considered orthopedic oncosurgeon, and he takes care of patients at both Apollo Cancer Center in Chennai at Proton and Kenarpet Junction also. And Dr. Rajiv is a considered orthopedic surgeon at Apollo Health City, Hyderabad. And we have Dr. Navneet, who's a consultant orthopedic oncosurgeon from Mangalore. And all our senior members from the OSS and KOA. So Dr. Navneet will be starting the program. So he'll be sharing his views on how to spot a bone tumor. Can I just kindly request Devolina to just allow the share screening for Mr. Navneet? Request from the faculties to, Dr. Navneet, sorry, request from the faculties to abide to the time. It's 12 minutes and we've got 2 to 3 minutes for discussion after each topic.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes, please.
Yeah, I'll try to stick to the time and please stop me if I'm exceeding the time limit. So thank you everyone. Thank you OSICON, OSIS office bearers and the KOA office bearers and Dr. Srimant and Dr. Suman. So we'll start with how to spot a bone tumor. So basically approach to bone lesion starts as usual with any medical condition with the history of complaints, the pain or whether the lesion is the lesion in the bone is incidentally detected, the duration of symptoms, the pain, the swelling, the limb, the difficulty in walking, the difficulty in standing, past history of any known malignancy, any solid organ malignancy like a kidney, lung or any other organ malignancies, treatment history of a previous biopsy or a previous surgery at the same site, and any family history. Clinical examination, I think everyone is familiar with the size of the lesion, the location, the consistency, the status of the adjacent joint, the status of the distal neurovascular bundle, and any loco-regional lymph nodes. These are the red flag signs pointing that a lesion is likely aggressive and which needs further care and attention. persistent localized bone pain, a fracture following a very insignificant trauma, a swelling which is not static, it's progressive, occurrence of a night pain or even a rest pain, and any past history of malignancies. So any of the following, any of the patient can come with any of the x-ray as seen above here. So what next? How do we determine what kind of lesion the person is suffering from? So we always start with what kind of bone is affected, whether a long bone is affected, whether a flat bone is affected, whether the bone from the axial skeleton, whether the trunk or the small bones of the hand and feet are affected. Then we move on to which part of the long bone is affected, whether it's a diaphysis, whether it's metaphysis, whether it's epiphysis or any lesion involving more, one or more zones in the long bone. If a vertebral body is involved, whether it's involving the anterior half or the posterior half of vertebral body, though it is not a rigid rule, most of the aggressive or malignant lesions involve the anterior half and the benign lesions involve the posterior half. But as I said, it's not a rigid rule. The age and location within a lesion also helps us have a differential. And in particular tumors like an adamantinoma here in the last image, where the most common site is a tibia, and in the parastal osteosarcoma where the posterior aspect of the distal femur is a very common site. So a particular type of bone, the location in that bone helps us give a narrow differential. What the lesion does to the bone. So whenever a lesion is there in the bone, it tries to grow. So in the first image, you can see that it's a geographic lesion. The lesion is single. The lesion is very well defined. And we can actually draw a line at the border of the lesion and a normal bone here. So this is a geographic pattern of destruction. Second is a moth eaten. So moth eaten, you see multiple discrete lytic areas with a diseased bone in between. So moth eaten is when the lesions are typically 2 mm to 5 mm in diameter. Permeative lesions are even more aggressive when the lysis which can be seen here are lesser than 2 mm. So a classical described textbook thing is that geographic is usually benign and the permeative ones are usually malignancy. But that is not the case. The pattern of bone destruction only tells us how aggressive the lesion is. Even an infective process can have a permeative appearance. Even a slow growing metastatic lesion can appear geographic. How do we decide a zone of transition? In the first image, you can see the lesion is in the metaphysis, trabeculated, expansile, well demarcated. And we can typically draw a line here where the lesion stops and a normal bone starts here. Same thing with the second image, but in addition to the clear zone of transition, you have a nice, beautiful sclerotic rim here. It says that the lesion is being there for quite some time and the body has enough time to form a sclerotic rim. On the third image, you can see there is no narrow zone of transition. Zone of transition is wide. It is difficult to tell where the normal bone starts and where the diseased bone ends. Matrix. What is the tumor forming? Whether the tumor is forming fibrosis tissue, whether a tumor is forming cartilage, whether a tumor is forming bone, or there is no matrix seen in the lesion at all. Coming to the periosteal reaction. So a periosteum is usually a fibrous layer and it's not seen on the x-ray. Periosteum forms bone when it is irritated by trauma, tumor or infection. So coming to a solid type of periosteal reaction, as you can see here. For example, this is a solid type of periosteal reaction. This is usually seen in benign conditions where the lesion has been latent for a very long time. As you can see, this is a case of an osteoid osteoma forming a reactive periostitis and a solid periosteal reaction. Coming to the lamellated periosteal reaction. So a lamellated periosteal reaction happens when the tumor has a lot of edema, which causes the intermittent expansion and relaxation of the periosteum, causing bone to be formed during every expansion and relaxation. This is a lamellated, uninterrupted type of periosteal reaction, which is usually seen in an osteomyelitis. And on the other hand, when you see a lamellated, interrupted periosteal reaction like this, as you see here in the previous image, the periosteal reaction is smooth. It is continuous and it can be traced all along. In this case, in the distal femur, you can see that the periosteal reaction is interrupted in between. These are signs of very aggressive neoplasms like an Ewing sarcoma. Coming to the spiculated appearance, where you can see there is newborn formation across the subperiosteal blood vessels, which is usually seen in Ewing's and osteosarcomas. And a Cordman's triangle, which is a hallmark feature of osteosarcoma, but also can be seen in acute osteomyelitis. You can see that the triangular part of the periosteum is elevated. But a main point to be noted, even by biopsy, I think it will be stressed again, that the periosteal reaction, whatever is formed, does not have tumor. So whenever we biopsy, we never biopsy the periosteal reaction, we always biopsy the tumor. So at the end, we have so many differentials overlapping with various age groups. So it's always a confusion to decide what to do next. So at the end of seeing an X-ray and evaluating a patient, we have four diagnostic possibilities. The first one is a touch me not lesion. These are incidentally detected lesions which do not require further intervention nor further treatment. This is an enchondroma detected here. It's a osteochondroma which is not troubling the patient, and a typical non-ossifying fibroma in the distal tibia. These do not require further imaging unless the patient is symptomatic. Any benign active lesion, benign aggressive lesion, and malignant lesion requires further imaging with full-length MRI with contrast. So the MRI helps us in delineating the extent of the lesion in the marrow. Compared to the X-ray here, the MRI gives us a better picture onto the marrow involvement. A full-length MRI is always required here. Better soft tissue delineation is obtained with the MRI than a CT scan. And you don't need a contrast to see the vessels here. Full length MRI is required only to know the skip metastasis. As you can see here, if the distal femur alone is screened on MRI, you generally tend to mix the skip metastasis on the proximal aspect. The MRI also helps in planning of a solid component. If you can see here, this is a contrast cross section, axial T1. Where you can see there is a large tumor in the posterior compartment. You can see the peripheral part of the tissue is taking up contrast, suggesting that it's a solid component, and the central part has patchy areas of necrosis. This will help us to do a biopsy from the peripheral aspect and not from the central aspect. And the final point which I wanted to stress on is how to differentiate between Ewing's and osteomyelitis. Clinical features can have overlap, the blood investigations can be an overlap, even the periosteal reaction, onion peel periosteal reaction can be confusing at times. So MR, as you can see here, it's a coronal T1 image, shows that the lesion is sharp circumscribed here. So I can draw a line here, differentiating the normal marrow from the tumor. On the other hand, in the second image, if you can see, there is extensive edema, so it is difficult to draw a line between the tumor and the normal bone. I think this reference will help to differentiate in cases between Ewing's and infection. So I've tried to summarize everything. I think we can keep the questions for later on.
So you are done with the presentation, Dr. Navin?
Yeah. I think I've not kept the metastasis part, so because it's covered by Dr. Vishnu, so I've prepared it.
Yeah, that's actually a very difficult topic, a long topic which you've taken, and you've tried to be pretty concise with that. Just request the faculty and the panelists over there, do you have any questions for Dr. Navin, sir? Okay, so one question which I have, Dr. Navin, is clinically, yes, someone was trying to ask. Yeah, sorry, Dr. Navneet, having infection that is tuberculosis or osteomyelitis versus a malignancy is a very, very common problem, because as you know, infection is the most commonest condition which we usually see across. Clinically and laboratory wise, are there any basic tests which we can do?
Yeah.
Complete blood count?
Yeah, you can do complete blood count, you can do an ESR and CRP, but as I said, you're differentiating at acute osteomyelitis from Ewing's is always difficult, because the ESR, CRP counts, everything will be high in Ewing's as well as in osteomyelitis. And even the clinical features, the local warm, the swelling, the tenderness, the age, everything match. Everything can be seen in both differential diagnosis. So the MRI will help us narrow it down. And in cases where there is Ewing's and osteomyelitis as a differential, when you do a biopsy, you always send for histopathology and culture both.
Okay.
But you need not do the same for a proper osteomyelitis or any other benign lesions. But in such cases, you'll have to do that.
Okay. Any role for alkaline phosphatase and lactate dehydrogenase in trying to differentiate between infection and tumors?
Yeah. The thing is, lactate dehydrogenase will be high in Ewing's, but if the tumor burden is less, LDH will still be normal. So I would not say that the LDH will help us in differentiating between Ewing's and osteomyelitis, because LDH can be even normal, less than 200 or 300, even in evenings, where the disease burden is low.
So basically, in the OPD, if someone comes across a patient with probably a likelihood of having infection versus malignancy, we can still do those CBC, ESR, CRP, and yes, alkaline phosphatase, LDH. Yes. And probably this is to be correlated with imaging and not taken individually over there trying to differentiate whether we're dealing with an infection or malignancy. Yeah, thank you. Any other questions or pointers from the faculty, please?
Srimad, I just made to want to make a point here. So as Dr. Navneet told, when we have a differential of infection versus Ewing's, when we take the sample, when you're sending for histopathology, send it the formalin, and when you're sending for culture sensitivity or gram stain, it has to be sent with saline. So that's the most important thing. But what we do is, as soon as we take the sample, we are used to put in formalin. So we have this differential diagnosis, we have to make sure that we send the sample separately in saline and formalin.
Yeah. So there's been a question on the question answer forum. They've again asked about what is the role of serum alkaline phosphatase. So any of the faculty would like to answer? Dr. Srinivasa, role of serum alkaline phosphatase. So I can't hear you, say your mic is off.
Yeah, so alkaline phosphatase is not a specific marker, but generally expected to be high in bone-forming lesions like osteosarcoma. It just adds to the diagnosis, but doesn't give us a conclusion on the diagnosis part. So do not take the alkaline phosphatase very seriously, but we do a screening of all the blood tests and we keep that also in mind.
But there is still a role of, elevated alkaline phosphatase more than 4 times, or a doubt of doing a serum PTH, especially to rule out a secondary hyperparathyroidism, right? So this doing an alkaline phosphatase routine would definitely not harm our profile is what we're looking at.
Yeah, when it comes to Brown's tumor, the alkaline phosphatase is expected to be very, very high. That is one of the indications, indicator markers. But for other lesions, it's not very specific.
Okay, thank you so much. Any other questions or points to be shared by the panelists and the faculty? Okay. So next is a topic where which Dr. Suman shared across. So what I'll be doing is I'll be presenting a small talk on how we actually do the biopsy. Sorry, I think it's a long screen. Yeah, can I just request Ms. Debelina to allow my screen sharing, please?
Sir, you are allowed to share. You can go ahead.
I'm allowed to share now? Okay, thank you. Let me just try to. Okay. Yes. Dr. Suman, my screen is visible, right?
Yeah, Suman, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much. Again, I'll take this opportunity to share my snippets of views on how do we do the biopsy, because again, Dr. Navneet has touched upon the clinical and radiological factors. Biopsy is the next third important step over there in trying to find out what we are dealing with. So why do we need to worry so much about it? Because definitely these tumors are rare. And if undiagnosed or misdiagnosed, there's actually a very high morbidity and mortality in trying to take care of these patients. The first important question which everybody faces is FNAC or biopsy. It's still being asked to us. We would say biopsy is the gold standard. And so FNAC...
Yes, sir? Your screen is not fully seen.
Okay. Let me just... Now it's seen, sir?
Yes, only half of it is seen. Yeah, now it's seen, sir. Yeah.
Now it's seen. Okay, I think there was a small error there. So when we talk about biopsy or FNAC, I would like to reiterate that it is not for a primary diagnosis. It's done only in a few cases of metastasis or a recurrence or a known case where the surgeon has already handled it. But again, the role is very, very limited. Biopsy is safe enough and it is given adequate tissue for us for all testings and further storage also. Why do we talk about it? Because definitely it's a serious business as shown in 1996 and 1992, and it's still prevailing even now also. So in the workup flow chart, we need to choose our path very wisely. And as I said, this is the third most important step. And whenever we miss these steps, we always find ourselves in trouble. And it's always good to go back again and try to check. So what are the principles of biopsy? We always try to do along the future planned incision. We try to target the periphery of the tumor and not the center. We obtain at least 3 to 5 cores of 1 centimeter each when feasible. Do not crush or divide the tissue. Always try to take the sample, give it to one pathologist, let them give the report, discuss with them, and then you can submit the samples for a different pathologist or a different team. And as Dr. Suman said, we always culture what we biopsy and vice versa. And please make, keep note of giving sample for biopsies and infections or gene experts separately. We rarely do open biopsy nowadays, but if we do, we always use a tourniquet to make sure that the hematoma is not too much. And IHC markers, immunohistochemistry markers to be precise over there, are available in abundance now. So we need to request them to confirm the diagnosis. And please discuss with the pathologist, share basically everything with the pathologist, and that's how you would get the right diagnosis. The different types, most of us do a biopsy in a J-needle or a core needle or image-guided again. Open biopsy is rarely done. True cut or ultrasound-guided again is done for soft tissue lesions. Most of these biopsies are done in local or general anesthesia based on the age, the location, and the system which is taking care of it. So the main questions we come across is, who should perform the biopsy? What part of the lesion needs to be biopsied? Safest anatomic route and how? So these are always tried to be placed in order, and never hesitate to ask for radiologist assistance to try to find out how can these be done. So who should perform? Ideally, we say the surgeon who is doing the definite surgery should perform the biopsy. Again, logistically, it's not feasible always. So we say that please do it under guidance. How and what to look for? Dr. Navneet has already shared his snippets on it. So it's very important to correlate the MRI and the X-ray and try to find out where is the good component of tissue we'll get the biopsy from. And this has to be matched in the anatomical route so that you don't land up with such inappropriate biopsies over there. So which anatomic route again? Always better to go through a single muscular plane and not the intermuscular plane so that this contamination is limited. Like for example, in the proximal humerus, we go through the anterolateral aspect of the deltoid. In the proximal femur, we try to go through the lateral approach or the medial approach depending on where the lesion is placed. In the distal femur, again, we try to take often the anteromedial approach, and if required, the tissue component is the lateral side, the anterolateral approach. Never midline through the rectus femoris or the quadriceps or posteriorly, please, because that would again preclude limb salvage. Proximal tibia, again, anteromedial, anterolateral, depending on where we find the tissue, based on the examples which I shared across. So I'll just share a small needle biopsy video. This is one of the most common biopsies which we do. So this is a Jamshedi needle on the left side, which we are seeing here. So this is a regular needle, which we use as an 8-gauge needle with a trocar and a stilet. And this is the image where we have this patient taken up for a biopsy and a local anesthesia in the outpatient basis. The future incision is marked. So once this incision is marked, we usually take a stab incision through a Levin blade, and always better to do this in image guidance because of the number of biopsies which we do and the surface markings which we know as surgeons, some of them are, including us, are comfortable doing it, especially if it's a peripheral or a bony tumor. But most of the lesions, it is always recommended to do an image guided biopsy so that we get the adequate tissue. So here, there is a local anesthesia infiltration, and this is done from the superficial aspect up to the periosteum. Please try to infiltrate it because once the needle goes in over there, there will be an acute or sharp intake of pain. So the stab incision will take through the component here. So once that is done, we try to use the biopsy needle. If the cortex is too thin, we can just easily walk into the lesion. If it's a bit thick, we'll have to use a bit of a circumscribed motion over there. And once we get into the lesion, depending on the type of the lesion, if it's a hard one, we'll have to do a circular motion and try to take it off. We can use a 20cc syringe to even aspirate the contents also, which will make sure that the tissue is stuck up in the tract. Here you can see that there's a bit of a aspiration or jog motion. This was a metaphyseal epiphyseal lesion, which was likely a giant cell tumor. As you can just show across, this is a tissue which we often get sometimes. So any sort of a cystic lesion, we do get these sort of tissues across. So once that is done, we take these cores, as you can see the number of cores here, and this is put in 10% formalin, and these are submitted to the pathologist. And then the assistant or the primary surgeon tends to hold the area under pressure, and the hematoma is reduced. So the advantages are quite a lot. It's basically done in the OPD basis, can be done in GA or local anesthesia also, short time, it's repeatable, most importantly, and the contamination is extremely less. The only disadvantage is, say, is that bleeding is not possible, but again, that they overcome, and they say that we cannot do gene sampling over there with this tissue, so very few centers in the world do an open biopsy for this. Gun biopsy for soft tissue tumors, again, it's a similar process where we use the TrueCut cores. So just a small example of the soft tissue mass here, you can see a pretty big mass in the foot. This was a sarcoma, which turned out to be a Query synovial sarcoma. As you can see, the process is still the same. Sorry about that. Yeah, so this is a gun again. So once we use the gun, we get cores like this, which can be taken out with a small blade, basically 11 blade. Try to access at least 3 to 5 long cores of at least 1 to 1.5 centimeters each, depending on the device which you use and the length of the gun which you have. And this again, it can be pushed across in 10% formalin, and further tests can be done across on that. Open biopsies, again, very rarely we do. If you ever come across, kindly don't go across through the the proper anatomical lines for limb salvage, and the grain is used, it has to be used on the line or in the line for the incision. So open biopsy has a lot more disadvantages. Again, as I said, we do it rarely, and it's not like we don't do it at all, but again, it's a properly planned and done needle biopsy under image guidance has given us good amount of tissue and has given us a good diagnosis for most of our surgeons. Ultrasound guided biopsy, again, this is another entity which we use along with a CT guidance or individually, where we try to target soft tissues. And again, it is very accurate, and it's minimally invasive. So this is how we try to go across the soft tissue mass, try to stay away from the necrotic area and try to target the solid area to take the sample. CT guided biopsy, again, it's comparatively with ultrasound guidance for deep seated lesions. And we can even do pediatric and geriatric cases, provided there is an anesthesia utility also in the CT room. So this is a very good flowchart about how we perform the biopsy where. So in appendicular skeletons, how we go about it, and axial skeletons, how we go about it, whether we do image guidance as CT or ultrasound or a fluoroscope, and how rarely we try to do an incisional biopsy with an intraoperative frozen section. So again, the utility of frozen section is not seen across. What I will reiterate is, frozen section cannot give you the diagnosis. It can only indicate whether you are getting the adequate sample or the representative sample or not. So having a frozen section facility is a very good idea if you're starting with biopsies under guidance, where you can make sure that you are in the right place in the to make sure you get the right diagnosis. So this is the suggested reading, which is on the AOS exhibit by one of our colleagues, Dr. Arani from Italy. So just to close across, the right path is very important. The high index of clinical suspicion and having no shortcut in trying to do the biopsy is also very, very important. And this is basically helped out by the use of a multidisciplinary team. So I'll be finishing my presentation as a last slide. Faculty and panelists, any inputs or any questions, please?
Shrimant, a lot of colleagues of ours ask us questions. I think you might also have got these questions. So is there any role of doing frozen in giant cell tumor? Why to do two procedures? Can we do frozen on table, confirm GCT and operate? So is it feasible, or do you advise to do biopsy before doing the procedure?
There are extremely few, or I would say even less than a handful of procedures where we try to do a procedure in the same setting. A giant cell tumor or a lytic lesion in the age criteria should always be biopsy, because a frozen section, as I'm reiterating again, cannot give the diagnosis. It can only tell us whether it is a giant cell tumor or not. And we know less than 1% of those tumors can be a component of osteosarcoma called as a giant cell rich osteosarcoma. So one should never try to do a primary surgery at the same sitting of a biopsy. Frozen section, repeating again, sorry, is only to aid us whether we're in the right place having tissue or not. I hope this probably answers the question in a simple way.
Yes, yes. So that's most important thing. Even in GCT, even image-wise, it looks like benign. It is better to do biopsy because we have seen a lot of cases which looks non-malignant on X-ray and having characteristic GCT findings. But most of the cases, when we do biopsy, in few cases, which have turned out to be osteosarcoma.
I think Dr. Srinivas has quite a bit of experience with secondary hyperparathyroidism, Brown's tumors, where he has seen a few cases wherein they have done biopsies and surgeries, where in fact, if you had done PTH and done a biopsy, we don't even need to treat the primary at all. Right, sir?
Yeah, these tumors are very heterogeneous and very confusing. Even to the best of the pathologist to give a proper diagnosis is very difficult. So unless you are absolutely sure, I think you should not attempt these surgeries.
Yes, sir. Any other pointers or questions, please? I think from the audience also, there are no questions as of now.
So, Ashimant, one more common question like which I get from my colleagues is, does cancer spread by doing biopsy?
I would say a well-planned and properly placed biopsy needle will not spread the cancer, even not much in the biopsy tract also. As a surgeon, we may be going a bit too far ahead. The tract is very small, not more than 7 to 8 millimeters in size. And in an image-guided biopsy with a single lesion, we have rarely even seen tumor seedings in the tract also when somebody has tried to measure them across. Whereas definitely, yes, if you do an open biopsy or an improperly planned needle biopsy, you can see the sample anywhere.
So that's a mild edema or the inflammation which we see post biopsy. Most of the patient get confused and they get worried that, you know, the tumor has increased after the biopsy. So it is better to inform them in advance there will be mild redness or even a mild swelling after the biopsy. So
That can be taken care of if the surgeon or the assistant is able to give good pressure immediately after the biopsy is being done, right? So at least 2 to 5 minutes of a constant pressure with the thumb itself on the with a counter will be more than comfortable over there to try to make sure that the swelling is gone away and the apprehension is taken care of.
Yes.
So there is one question which has been asked again. If we happen to do a biopsy and it turns out to be an infective lesion, can it form a sinus tract? Can I just request Dr. Pramod, if he's online over there, just to answer this, sir?
Yeah, hi.
Should I repeat the question, sir? Hello? Okay. Yes, sir?
The infection, does it cause a sinus? Yeah, you can hear me.
Yes, sir, I can hear you, sir. So basically the question is, if they happen to do a biopsy and it turns out to be an infective lesion, can it form a sinus tract?
Yeah, if it's not treated, definitely it forms a sinus tract. So once it's turned out to be an infection, you need to treat it. So it got sinus tracts. Now in this era, we should not have it with so much of advanced methods of treating them. Yeah.
Definitely.
So if it, yeah.
And I think probably there's one more... Yeah, there's another question which I will just ask Dr. Pramod again because you got him online here. So the giant cell tumor of the ulnar head or the fibular head, do you need to do biopsy or directly excise for biopsy is that question?
No, there is no tumor without biopsy, man. I mean, definitely every tumor, everything has to be biopsied. And we have seen the ups and downs of not doing biopsy. So, but definitely, particularly in this forum, there is no question that without doing a biopsy, you're going to do any surgery.
I think I would like to add saying that there has been quite a bit of awareness in the orthopedic oncology along with the patients also. So I guess when we look at patient safety and we look at the medico-legal issues, I believe biopsy has a very, very important role to play in the management of the patient.
Yeah, and that's what I wanted to mention, Srimant, because nobody can sue us for doing a biopsy.
Yes.
Even if turned out to be infection or non-tumorous condition. But if we operate and something goes wrong, then medico-legally we are in big problem. So I always say better to put needle first before knife.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, even if it's an infection also, it will let us know, right? If it's a, basically a culture or a gene expert or QLNSA can let us know what we're dealing with, even though infection is the most commonest. So it would definitely not harm us. I think Dr. Vishnu Ramanujam also answered the same, saying that we need to do a biopsy. There's another question if Dr. Kishore Reddy sir is available. So the question is, biopsy from a pathological fracture, how to go about it?
Yeah, hi, Srimath. So from the pathological fracture, we need to do a biopsy, of course, you know, as Pramod and Vishnu had already pointed out. We need to do the biopsy. And before doing a biopsy, probably it's better to get a PET done.
Yes, sir.
I mean, and then localize where is the most aggressive part of the lesion, and then pick up from that and then do a biopsy. And if there is a, you know, if it's a delayed fracture, especially in a case where we are suspecting osteosarcoma, that becomes a bit of a challenge. And I mean, a delayed fracture, and we should target the end, not at the ends, you know, where there is a reparative bone, try to target at the area which is available, so that, you know, we get the histologically relevant sample.
I believe a contrast enhanced MRI would be able to.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Yeah, MR, that goes without saying, no? Wherever we, there are two things in orthopedic oncology what we follow: soft tissue tumors, and when there is a recurrence, and when we are suspecting edema versus tumor, these are conditions where you know, contrast helps us a lot.
Yes, sir. So the takeaway from this question is that we should biopsy a pathological fracture, but if the facility is available, we should do a PET scan or at least a basic chest X-ray ultrasound to make sure that we know what we're dealing with.
And most important thing is avoid the fracture site.
Yeah, that's also, again, you don't want a reactive osteoid formation mimicking something else also, right? Definitely. So, okay, I guess Dr. Navneet also answered the question. So any more inputs or pointers for the biopsy site, sir?
Yeah, don't biopsy the periosteal reaction.
Yeah, I think Dr. Navneet mentioned about the same.
Very important. You see a large speculated periosteal reaction and you tend to biopsy, that's just a reactive bone. You're not targeting the lesion at all. So avoid biopsying a periosteal reaction, just a reactive component.
Okay.
And one more thing I want to point out here is that we need to have a dialogue open, and the pathologist should be well aware of the case. Yes. This happens many times, you know, that pathologists are not aware of the case because they see the slide, and with the slide, they cannot just imagine things. So we need to have ORP meetings, and where we need to discuss and make the pathologist aware of the clinical diagnosis and what we are thinking, so that you know, they think in those possible lines.
Definitely. So communication is the key to get any diagnosis.
Yeah, as orthopedic oncology is a team work, you know, it's just not an individual surgery.
Okay. I think probably the questions have ended. Thank you so much. I request Dr. Srinivas Chiripuri, senior consultant orthopedic oncosurgeon, to share his principles of extended curettage and limb salvage surgery in a concise setting. Ms. Debelina, if you can just allow screen sharing for Dr. Srinivas.
Sorry, Shriman, there's another question.
Yes, sir.
In the chat box.
Just check it up, sir.
In the chat box, GCT of ulnar head or fibular head, do you know?
We've answered, sir. We've answered.
Yeah. Okay.
It has to be biopsy first.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir. You'll have to go to the presenter view, sir. Yes, sir. Now it's visible.
Yeah. Good evening, all. First of all, thank you so much for having me in this forum. It's a great opportunity to meet all of you. So I'll be sharing, talking about two aspects. One is about the curettage principles, and the second thing is about principles of limb salvage surgeries. Two big topics. I don't know how I'll cover, but anyway, I'll try to be as concise as possible. So the first and foremost thing is to get the diagnosis right. A lot of times we see that surgeons read the MRI report or X-ray report and they go and take the patient for surgery. Now, radiological diagnosis is not good enough. As we just discussed, that histopathology diagnosis is the most important thing before you do any major surgeries. So in giant cell tumors, basically we operate based on, we plan the surgery based on the radiological images, whether
the lesion is contained, or is it expansile, or is there a pathological fracture and things like that. So X-ray image will help us to decide on the course of treatment. Before you touch the patient, it's better to have a proper image in terms of CT scan, which will tell you the structural integrity of the bone, which part of the bone is involved, and it will tell you what approach to take. If the lesion is involving the posterior aspect, the approach should be posterior. If it's involving anterior, it should go anterior. So that is important. The second thing is having an MRI will help you in knowing the soft tissue extent, especially the marrow joint involvement and things like that. Now, in giant cell tumor, there are two options, either you curette or you resect. How do you decide this? The small lesions, which can be curetted and reconstructed, can be managed with a simple procedure. There are some lesions where you just curette and you don't even have to reconstruct. In other lesions, we curette it with cement or bone graft or other options. There are lesions like this which are very aggressive benign tumors, where there's a path fracture, or you can't salvage this where there's no bone or contour. We recommend resection and reconstruction. So basically, curettage involves surgeries which are performed under tourniquet, because giant cell tumors are very vascular. Wherever possible, use tourniquet, excise the entire biopsy scar along with the tumor, protect the soft tissues with hydrogen-soaked mops and gauze pieces, make a large opening, not a window, not a door, basically remove entire wall, and get a 360-degree view of the entire lesion. We do a gross curettage, removing the visible tumor. And then this is how it would look post-curettage. Now, this is not good enough. Normally, if you do this and then pack it with cement or bone graft, you can be assured that the tumor will recur. So what we do is, apart from this, we do what is called an extended curettage. Basically, apart from curating whatever is visible, we remove whatever is one layer of normal bone all around. It could be soft tissue, it could be periosteum, it could be bone. We remove an extent of normal bone along with the tumor and wash it with a copious amount of hydrogen peroxide, saline. Earlier, we used to use phenol and alcohol to cauterize the margins, but we have stopped using this. Nowadays, what is the most important factor is using high-speed burr. That's single most factor which will reduce the recurrence chances. Sometimes we use argon laser cautery to burn the lesion, and this is called as an extended curettage. This will ensure that microscopic cells are also killed, so that we can reduce the incidence of recurrence. You should take a lot of time to curette it, because if you leave any part of the tumor, the chance of recurrence is very high, and whatever reconstruction you do will fail. So I think that is the most important aspect of the surgery, to curette it adequately. Be aggressive. Do not try to save tissues. You have to be as radical as possible when you're dealing with these benign aggressive tumors. Reconstruction is the second aspect of the surgery. This depends on whether there is a subchondral bone, adequate subchondral bone or not. So if you have a adequate subchondral bone which is more than 2 millimeters, reconstruction is much more simpler. We usually use struts to pack the cavity, or we can use a cement. We don't believe in packing the cavity with motionless grafts or bone substitutes. These tumors are very vascular. We just have to support the cavity, and the rest of the cavity gets filled up. So you don't need to pack the entire cavity. If the subchondral bone is less than 2 millimeters, the reconstruction is a little bit more challenging. We use either the bone or cement, or in combination of both. The idea is basically to reconstruct the subchondral bone with bone, either with allograft or autograft. And you can either put a cement or support the strut with fibula or any other bone. This is called as a sandwich technique, and this is called the T-construct. Sometimes you are left with only cartilage after curettage, so this will be also treated similarly. This is an example of a T-construct. What we do is, under the subchondral bone, we pack motionless graft. We put a strut graft, generally we use a tricortical ilicris graft. To support that, we use fibula, either allo or autograft. And suppose if there's a pathological fracture or impending fracture, we may use a plate. Sometimes we use care wires to support these. This is an example of a T-construct which has been done. And this entire cavity over a period of time gets ossified. You don't need to actually pack this cavity with bone. Tumors like pelvis, in bones like pelvis, earlier we were using angioembolization to reduce the vascularity, and then we used to go and operate because these lesions are very vascular. These days we use denosumab injections, which will reduce the size of the tumor, also reduce the vascularity. We use 2 to 3 doses, and then sometimes do angioembolization and take the patients for curettage. We either do excision or curettage, and we reconstruct. When you're using denosumab, you should be extremely careful. It produces a lot of fibrous tissue, so we have to very radically curate these areas to prevent recurrence. Tumors like this, where there's a papillary fracture and the bone quality is very poor, generally we recommend resection and reconstruction either with a megaprocessus or an arthrodesis. But sometimes, you know, we in expert hands, we can salvage these kind of joints. Like in this case, we do extensive curettage. We remove everything that is visible except the cartilage, and we reconstruct with allograft or autografts and plate it. Important thing is to curate it adequately and maintain the joint congruity and then the alignment of the bone. And so this lady fortunately did not have any recurrence. The bones are nicely ossified. There is some limitation of joint movements, but she's quite happy with what she has. The good thing is she doesn't have any recurrence. So the role of denosumab, we have tried a lot the last 4 or 5 years. We have done a lot of things and burnt our hands as well. So these injections, adjuvants, are generally now limited to tumors which are not resectable in pelvis, sacrum, spine. And in the limbs, wherever we have, where we want to salvage it and do curettage, sometimes we use denosumab and reduce the size of the lesion and attempt a curettage and salvage of these cases. But then you have to be very careful about recurrence rates with denosumab. So this is a case of a GCT of the sacrum. Somebody attempted curettage and tried to re-stabilize it. The tumor came back. She ended up with the bowel and bladder incontinence. She also had ureter compression and renal failure. We used denosumab. Can you, if you see this large lesion which was there, we gave multiple shots of denosumab and angioembolization. This tumor shrunk quite a lot. Visibly, the swelling came down, pain came down, her parameters improved. This was, and we managed to keep her on denosumab for a few years. And later, she died because of UTI and renal failure. The second topic I'm touching upon is the principles of limb salvage surgery. So the one and most important thing is these are surgeries which are to be done with a team effort. You can't do it in isolation. You need to have a good medical oncologist, radiation oncologist, a good physiotherapist. Entire team should be available, a good pathologist and radiologist whom you can rely on. Only then we should attempt these treatment protocols and treatment surgeries. Now, the most important thing in dealing with malignant bone tumors is to make the right decision. And how do you make the right decision? So you should know a lot of things before you talk to the patient. We see whether the patient has a tumor which is localized or metastatic. By doing a staging, we do a local staging, local MRIs, PET scan or bone scan, and CT thorax, and then know whether the lesion is localized or metastatic. The second thing we do is to see whether the limb is salvageable. Can we excise the tumor and give a good function? That's another thing which we keep in mind. And the other factors are, can the patient afford the treatment that you're giving? Can we afford, are there reliable patients who can take chemotherapy, radiotherapy? And what are the chances that patient may need re-surgeries and things like that? All these have to be kept in mind before you actually talk to the patient and touch the patient. Now, one common question that people ask us, by doing a limb salvage, are you compromising the survival? Are you increasing the chance of local recurrence? There are a lot of articles which suggest that if you do a proper limb salvage and give adjuvant therapy, the survival is the same whether you do amputation or limb salvage. And with respect to local recurrence, the chance of local recurrence is very less with our skilled effort. The local recurrence rates are 5 to 6%, which is quite acceptable. So we can go ahead and do limb salvage without compromising the patient's life. So it's not only about the surgery that we do, it's about how else we can treat so that we can reduce the recurrence rates and increase the survival of the patient. So in cases like osteosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma, it's very important that you counsel the patients about the chemotherapy. Wherever possible, please use chemotherapy. This will reduce the vascularity of the tumor before the surgery. It will increase compliance of the patients. It will make surgical margins much more safer. And the survival overall will increase. Just by operating, the survival is less than 25%. But when you add chemotherapy and other adjuvants and surgery, the survival rate goes up from 60 to 70%. Now, before we plan a limb salvage, it's very important to have a good imaging. We always plan surgeries based on the pre-chemotherapy MRIs. And if you're dealing with osteosarcoma or Ewing sarcoma, chemotherapy also makes limb salvage very easy and accessible. And it also, we have to have a good planning about the reconstruction, especially in pediatrics where the reconstructions are quite complex, and we have to keep long-term survival of the reconstruction in mind. Now, one thing about the surgical is we have used a lot of terminologies. People use radical excision, debulking, wide excision. So what are these? What is the right way of doing excising these tumors? We follow Enneking's classification. Basically, what we do is, if this is a normal tissue, normal body tissue, and suppose there's a tumor, the red part is the tumor, and the black lining is the capsule of the tumor. And we expect cells, malignant cells, to be in the periphery, in the capsule, or outside the capsule in the soft tissues. So it's very important, if you want to remove the entire tumor, it's important that we remove this lesion with the normal tissue all around. That is called as wide excision. And that normal tissue could be bone. We usually keep a margin of around 3 to 5 centimeters bone. When you're doing limb salvage, we think about 2 to 3 centimeters. When you're planning an amputation, we keep 5 centimeters bone margin. We can use a healthy muscle to cover the tumor. We can sometimes take the physis as a margin, periosteum as a margin. When you're dealing with the nerves, so the nerve is very close, we excise the tumor with the perineurium of the nerve. If the vascularity is very close, we excise it with the adventitia of the vessels. When you're dealing with the nerves and vessels, we can go a little bit closer to the tumor, but otherwise you should never open the tumor, never look into the tumor, stay away from the tumor. That's the bottom line. If you open the tumor, there will be seeding, and patient will invariably end up with local recurrence, and they probably can die. A lot of people do an improper excision. They open the tumor and then send it to radiotherapy for thinking that radiotherapy will reduce the local recurrence rates. But that doesn't work. You have to be extremely careful when you're excising these tumors. You have to have adequate margins before you plan any reconstruction. So there are two things we keep in mind when you're doing a limb salvage. One, can we excise this tumor completely? Number two, whatever limb is left behind with reconstruction, does it have an adequate function? If these two prerequisites are taken care of, then we can plan a limb salvage. Otherwise, we recommend amputation to these patients. So once we excise this tumor, we send it for for analysis, especially if the patient has undergone chemotherapy before the surgery. We send it to the histopathology analysis. We call it as WAS grading. They cut open the tumor and they analyze. They look into the necrosis aspect in the tumor. More the necrosis, better the response to chemotherapy and better the prognosis. This is a case of a lytic lesion in the proximal tibia. Somebody thought it's a GCT. They did an FNAC, and based on that report, they went and did a curettage. The doctor was happy, but 3 months later, 3 to 4 months later, patient came to us with a large recurrence. And when we did the biopsy, it turned out to be an osteosarcoma. A benign-looking tumor could be anything. So a properly done biopsy can actually prevent such hazards. So this patient underwent chemotherapy, and then we did a wide excision. We removed all those contaminated zones. She completed her chemotherapy, and it's been 11 years now. She's married. She has 2 kids. She's doing well now. She's been quite fortunate. This is a case of an osteosarcoma in the distal femur. This patient underwent, when the patient came to me with X-ray, I did an entire length MRI, and we saw a skip lesion in the neck of the femur. Very important to screen the entire bone when you're dealing with osteosarcomas, because skip lesions can be there and you can miss it. So we did a radical excision where we removed the entire bone and replaced with a total femur replacements. Patient could walk on the second day and he did well for some time. Sometimes we have sarcomas, they may have lung metastasis. If the lung mets can be excised, we should attempt it. If it's not accessible, then we put them into palliative care. But in this case, she had an chondrosarcoma in the ileum and 3 or 4 nodules in the lung. So we took her for surgery, we excised the ileum with the acetabulum, radiated the bone and put it back and fixed it with plates and screws. We also, in the same sitting, we excised the lung nodules. And fortunately, she survived for 12 years now. She's got a child. She's now expecting the second child. This is a case of a synovial sarcoma, twice operated early back. And then there's a synovial sarcoma in the olecranon region. We can see there's a lesion extending into the elbow. In such cases, we do what is called an extra-articular resection. We have to excise the distal humerus and the olecranon in one piece and then plan reconstruction. So these are called extra-articular resections where we do not open the joint, otherwise lead to contamination. Of course, then whatever nerves could be salvaged were salvaged. Fortunately, she got an allograft, ulna allograft, and we also got a custom-made elbow joint. And the reconstruction was done. And she has, and we did a LD pedicle flap. She got good movements of the elbow. She's done well now. It's been more than 5 years since we did the surgery. But the principle is do not open the joint, do not contaminate the area. Excise, go wide and excise these lesions. Well, not all results come out as we expect. These are extensive surgeries and they're bound to have complications. One of the dreaded complications in dealing with malignant tumors is infection. I can tell you that with good surgical skills and good soft tissue coverage, we hardly see infections. I can tell this across all our faculty that our infection rates are very, very low because we follow a lot of principle when you're dealing with soft tissues and we cover a bit adequately. But sometimes, we end up with infections and these infections have to be handled aggressively and treated so that the adjuvant chemotherapy should not suffer. If the patient is on chemotherapy, they need to go back to chemotherapy as early as possible. So we aggressively treat these infections. Sometimes we end up doing amputations, but chemotherapy should not suffer. Sometimes when you're aggressive, we tend to do, when we compromise the margins, we end up with the local recurrences. I can definitely say that our local recurrences are less than 5 to 6%. But it's very important that we plan these surgeries very well, to have a good MRA and plan the surgeries well so that we can reduce the local recurrence. And whenever patients come for follow-up, we have to be extremely vigilant to look for these signs of local recurrence. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. That was actually, as you said, two big topics, concise in 15 minutes. So that's a very, very good overview of how to, do curettage and how to do limb salvage. Any inputs from the panelists or the faculty, please? Sir, could you just unshare your screen, sir, if you don't mind?
Yep.
So what's important here is that you not only showed the outcomes and how to do things, but also what can go wrong, because it's very important for a surgeon who's looking or a team member who's trying to deal with these tumors to actually understand the whole spectrum of benefits and risks. It's not very heroic to just go and do a limb salvage. You should be actually competent enough to even try to handle the complications. And I think how we reduce the complications, how we actually get a better outcome, Dr. Suman is going to share his views on the reconstruction options, what we do, what we have done, and what actually can be tried out also. Can I just ask Dr. Suman to just start his presentation, see if you can just share the screen?
Yeah, is my screen visible, Suman?
Yes, please. Kindly go ahead. Okay.
So thank you so much. Thanks to Srinivas, sir. He made my talk easy. He has covered almost everything. So it's very important, as Dr. Srinivas mentioned, it's very important to excise the tumor en bloc with good soft tissue cover all around. Once we take out the tumor, next the challenge is the reconstruction. So there are two reconstruction which we need to do. One is the bony reconstruction, other one is the soft tissue reconstruction. So today I'm not talking about soft tissue reconstruction. We are just talking and focusing about bony reconstruction, which we do in bone tumors. So there are mainly two options which we have when we think about a reconstruction. One is biological and another one is non-biological options. So what is an ideal reconstruction? So ideal reconstruction should be easily available. It should be easy to use, stable, and it should give a good function. It should increase the quality of life, and on that it should be less expensive, and it should have a good longevity. So we'll see and discuss the advantage and disadvantages of each reconstruction, what we have in our armamentarium. So there are two types of bony resection what we do. The first one is the osteoarticular resection, where the cut will be through the joint and the second cut will be through the metaphysis or the diaphysis of the bone. So in this case, we need to reconstruct the joint. The second type of resection is the intercalary resection, so where the resection is between the two joints, so where we'll be taking up the metadiaphyseal area of the bone. So first we'll talk about osteoarticular resection. So the one and only reconstruction which is available and which gives excellent result when we are reconstructing the joint is use of mega prostheses. So nowadays we have a modular prostheses which are easily available. We don't need to order, and we can reconstruct as much as possible. And most commonly used sites are, as we know, is the distal femur and the proximal tibia. So this is a case of a distal femur osteosarcoma, where the tumor has been completely excised with a good soft tissue margin all around, and the defect has been replaced by using a megaprosthesis. So what is the advantage of this megaprosthesis? So the advantage is we can make the patient walk immediately and start the knee range of movement. So that will reduce the complication associated with a long-term bedridden cases. So the patient will be mobile, and it helps to start the adjuvant treatment as early as possible. And this gives excellent result even in the long term. So this patient, you can see after 6 months, he's having complete knee range of movement and is having a near walking gait. So the next common area where we use the megaprosthesis is the proximal tibia. As you can see the picture here, it's a modular prosthesis. We can attach and increase the length like how much we want based on the amount of resection which we have done. And nowadays, these newer implants will have this rotatory platform you can see here. So along with the flexion and extension, they also provide the rotation. So that gives the better outcome function-wise and also increases the life of the prosthesis. So this implant also helps to reconstruct the whole length of the bone. For example, in the femur, we can excise the total femur and replace with total femur prosthesis, and same with the humerus. So here is a case, it was a chondrosarcoma of the proximal femur operated outside and a THR done, and there is contamination of the whole femoral canal because of the reaming. So in this case, we plan to do a total femur extra-articular resection, means without opening the hip joint, to resect the acetabulum and the entire femur. And that has been done. You can see here the cut in the supra-acetabular area, and you can see the vessel along the whole length of the femur, and you can see the sciatic now here. So, and we have used the total femur prosthesis to reconstruct in this case, and we have used the simple mesh to tie the femoral head to the ILM to create the pseudoarthrosis. So that is the X-ray, and you can see the function of the patient. So this patient is walking without acetabulum and with full femur replaced with the prosthesis. So same thing when it comes to humerus. So this is the case of a sarcoma of the humerus, where the complete bone has been involved. So the tumor has been completely excised and replaced using the total humerus prosthesis. So this is the function of the patient. So in this case, as the deltoid and the axillary nerve has been sacrificed, so patient won't have any deltoid function, but he has a stable wrist and elbow to carry out most of his basic activities. So that's a shoulder abduction he is getting because of mainly scapulothoracic movement. That's a extension and the flexion possible. So the other non-biological reconstruction are the spacers. So what are the spacers? So there's a case of Ewing sarcoma involving the almost 90% length of the humerus. So the tumor was quite big. So we had planned to give radiation post-surgery. So none of the prosthesis, mega prosthesis, will fit until and unless we get a customized prosthesis for this patient. So the patient was not affordable. So what we did, we used the simple, we resected the whole tumor, used the simple plate and nail and cement around. So this is, we call it as a nail cement spacer. So on this, we can give radiation and the patient adjuvant treatments are not delayed. So this is the function of the patient. So you can see the almost 90% of the humerus has been removed and replaced with this spacer. Still the patient got a decent function. So other permanent spacer are, for example, the tumor involving the proximal humerus. And we know that the patient is going to lose the deltoid and axillary nerve, and patient is not going to have any shoulder function. So that's a intraop picture. So whole deltoid has been kept on the tumor, and the medially, these are the vessels which are dissected after removing the tumor. So that's a prosthesis. And we use this mega prosthesis to put as a spacer in that area. So that will give us stable elbow and wrist for the function. So patient can do decent function and lift decent weight with that shoulder. So other advantage of using non-biological mega prosthesis is having a tumor which can grow with patient age, because we know that osteo and Ewing sarcomas are more common in skeletal immature patient. If you put a regular prosthesis, the patient may land up with limb dense discrepancies. So how this prosthesis works? So you can see the prosthesis here, which has a telescoping tube inside, and it will have a magnetic coil here. The implant is placed in the patient body like regular prosthesis, and the patient, when comes to follow up, it kept in the coil and the magnetic field is activated. So it helps in opening of this telescoping tube. So each time when the patient comes for follow up once in 3 to 6 months, we expand the leg by 4 to 5 millimeters. So that's how we maintain the length of the leg. So you can see this is the immediate post-op X-ray. So there is no space between these tubes. And this is the X-ray post-expansion. So you can see there is a gap of 1 centimeter. So we have lengthened the leg to 1 centimeter, use this processes. So this is the function of the patient. So this function, patients will have excellent function without any limb dense discrepancies, and they'll be able to perform all the activities. So another use of using this mega prosthesis, as I told you, they help in early mobilization. So patient with secondaries like bone metastasis or primary metastatic bone cancer with poor prognosis, who have a very short period of life and we want to give a good quality of life, we can use this prosthesis. For example, this is a case of CL lung with a light eclosion in the trochanter. The whole trochanter has been excised and replaced with the prosthesis, and that is the function of the patient. So he is independent, he is able to walk, and he is able to ride his bike. So it will completely change the quality of life with the mega prosthesis. So, but as we know, the mega prosthesis has a few downsides. One is the longevity, because we have to replace after certain time because of various reasons like loosening or aseptic loosening. But newer designs like rotatory platform and HA-coated stems have increased the life of this prosthesis. So the advantage is early mobilization gives good joint movement, improve the quality of life. They are easily available, stable, and they're durable. And they don't interfere much with the treatment because less chance of infection, and we can start radiation immediately. And it's best used in the patient with a poor outcome. So coming to biological reconstruction. So earlier we used to use a lot of allograft, but the biggest challenge of using allograft is getting a size matched peak strut allograft. So we know that there's we have only one I think in Mangalore also it has started one, the bone bank. So getting such a big size matched allograft is a big problem. So what we have started is, we have started using the patient own tumor bones.
Dr. Suman, can you hear us? I think the sharing has just stopped abruptly.
I think there's some network issues with Suman.
Yeah, I think there's a network issue. Ms. Devarina, can you just unshare and try to check if we can just get Dr. Suman on back online back again, please.
Yes, he has stopped to share you.
Yeah, I think there must be a sudden drop in the network issue or something.
Just wait for some time.
Yeah, yeah. Let me just contact him in a minute. Yeah. So basically, there's a small technical issue. I think he should be online in the next half a minute or so. I think we'll just wait for it. Bharat sir, we are on a bit on time, right? So I think we'll just wait for Dr. Suman and then we should be able to jump out to the case discussion.
No issues, no issues.
Yes, sir. So in the meantime, until Dr. Suman logs in, until his technical issue is sorted out, just wish to ask the attendees if there is any other questions you wish to put across for the principals in extended curettage and limb salvage. We have answered about the need of denosumab in certain areas. I think that was the last answer Dr. Vishnu and myself just gave a bit of information on that. Anything pertaining to limb salvage extended curettage, please. If there's any question, this is a good time to ask. Okay, Dr. Suman is back online. I think we'll just allow him to share his presentation back again.
Okay, my screen is visible, Srimant?
Yes, it's visible.
Suman. It's visible.
So this is a case where the ECRT has been done for diaphyseal tumor in the tibia. So once the fracture unites, it's almost like a normal bone and patient will be able to do all the activities. So the second method is what we call it as cryotherapy. So where the bone, we dip it in liquid nitrogen, which is around minus 195 degrees, kill all the cells and put it back. So this is a case of Ewing's of the proximal femur. We have given chemotherapy, patient has responded well. So we have done this liquid nitrogen in this case. So this is a small video showing the procedure. So we have gone through the lateral approach. So the cut has been taken proximally to the tumor with 2 cm margin in the intratrochanteric area. So with the help of SIAM. So the other end is kept intact with the limb. So the soft tissue covering over the tumor has been removed and we have taken liquid nitrogen in a container. And the rest of the limb is covered with cotton and mops. Make sure that liquid nitrogen doesn't come in contact with this leg. And the bone is dipped in the liquid nitrogen for about 20 minutes. So that will kill all the tumor cells and also normal cells. So it will be like a dead bone, that part. So once it's dipped, it's kept in room temperature for 15 minutes. then washed with saline for another 15 minutes. So you can see the ice crystal forming on the bone, and the bone is fixed in place with the help of plate and screw. So the advantage of doing this procedure is we are just cutting the bone at one point, so the union is early and the patient mobilization and outcome will be better. So soon after the procedure, the patient was started on knee range of movement and non-weight bearing mobilization. After 3 months, the X-ray showed good union at the proximal part. So patient was started on full weight bearing. So she is having complete hip and knee range of movement with a normal gait. So we have used this technique even in osteoarticular lesions. So this is a proximal tibia periosteal. So ideally we take off this 20 centimeter of periosteal bone and replace with tumor processes. So what we have done in this case, we have used liquid nitrogen, killed all the cells and done only surface replacement. So we have reduced the amount of metal in this case. And so that's a post-op X-ray. So that is a function of the patient. So it gives excellent function, and also we are saving a lot of bone. So if the patient requires revision, that will be very handy. So other biological reconstruction are in case of forearm and leg, where we have two bones, we can use a neighbor bone for reconstruction. For example, this is a case of lesion in the distal distal radius GCT. So we have excised the distal radius and shifted the ulna to that place and fixed with the help of plates and screws. So that we call it as ulna translocation. So that will give a stable wrist and a very good function. So patient will have good finger function and rotation, and that's a pronation and supination of the forearm. So same concept can be used even in the lower limb. So if there's a lesion in the tibia, the lesion can be excised and the fibula can be shifted in this place. As the patient weight bears progressively, there is thickening of the tibia, so that we call it as tibialization of fibula. So another method of biological reconstruction is rotation plasty. So if there's a tumor in the distal femur or a proximal tibia, if the patient is not affordable for expandable processes, he has to undergo an abony amputation. So instead of that, here we are converting into a below knee amputation. So here the tumor is removed. The leg is rotated 180 degrees posteriorly and is brought up and stabilized. So that is the intraop picture. So the whole segment is connected only with the artery and the vein. So that's the immediate post-op picture. So this is the function of the patient. So this patient has been operated by Tata in at Tata Hospital. So I have taken this video from there. So that's the elbow movement. So ankle movement. So ankle will be acting like knee now. So patient will be using a prosthesis. So with this, the patient will get excellent function. But only disadvantage is as the leg is rotated backwards, it is cosmetically quite disfiguring. Otherwise, it gives excellent function. So coming to pelvis, there are four types of pelvic resections. So type one is removal of ileum. When we remove the ileum, usually we don't do any reconstruction. Type two is removal of acetabulum, so that is the hip joint, part of hip joint. So we have to do reconstruction in type 2. Type 3 is when we remove the superior and inferior rami, usually we don't do any reconstruction. Type 4 is when we remove the sacrum, usually we don't do any reconstruction. So we talk about type 2. So once we remove the acetabulum, the hip joint is compromised. So there are various ways of reconstructing the hip joint. So the simplest method is the meshplasty, where we are going to tie the head to the ileum or the remaining part of the bone with the help of a simple mesh. So that will cause pseudoarthrosis. Next, as I showed you, we can use a sterilized tumor bone either after ECRT or cryo and put it back. And next option is using prosthesis. So this is a case, Ewing sarcoma in a 4-year-old child, chemotherapy given, patient responded very well. So we did a type 1 and partial type 2 resection. These are the intraop pictures showing the sciatic nerve in the sciatic notch, and this from the intrapelvic view. So the cut has been taken at the triradiate cartilage. So that's the head. So we have used the mesh to suture the head and tie with the acetabulum, part of the inferior acetabulum which was left. So this is the post-op 3D reconstructed image of the patient, and this is the function after 3 years. So he is having shortening of around 2 centimeters, but he is able to walk and he is able to do most of his activities. So other option, as I mentioned, we can sterilize the bone and put it back. And nowadays we have this 3D reconstruction, and also we can use patient-specific cutting jigs to take a precise cut intraoperatively. So this is one such case, Ewing sarcoma of the femur. Ewing sarcoma of the pelvis. So we got this 3D reconstruction and planned our cut before surgery, and we could save the part of the sacroiliac joint. So that, and also reconstruction was planned before the procedure. So same has been executed. So excised type 3, type 2 with partial type 1, and whole bone was irradiated and put it back and stabilized with the help of plates and screws. So other option is the processes. We don't do much processes, mainly because they have to be custom made. They are very expensive and high chance of failure chances, and also infection. So coming to biological, usually they are associated with late complication, and if we achieve union, usually we get away with single surgery. They give very good functional outcome, but the downsides are slightly associated with higher infection compared to the megaprocesses, and union and delayed union are the issues with the biological reconstructions. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Suman. Again, trying to be very comprehensive but still concise in sharing the reconstruction methods. I guess we forgot to add one point, the use of vascularized fibula, the role of vascularized fibula in these surgeries also. So how often do you recommend a vascularized fibula in reconstructions, biological reconstructions?
Vascularized fibula as alone in the lower limb, especially when you are reconstructing the femur, we don't use alone because there's high chance of fracture. So usually if you are doing a biological reconstruction, we're using either ECRT and cryo, and if the segment is in the lower limb is more than 20-25 centimeter, we add vascularized fibula there to help the union and also to achieve extra stability in that area. In tibia, yes, it can be used in isolation. We can use a vascularized fibula, but most of the times we get away by shifting the neighbor fibula. So need of vascularized fibula in tibia is less if you have a intact fibula on the same side.
Yeah, actually, I would just like to conclude this session by just getting Dr. Kishore Reddy online. Sir, do you recommend vascularized fibula as a primary procedure, or what's your experience as a salvage procedure, sir, in oncological conditions?
Yeah. One second. Okay. Yeah. Hi, Sri. So vascularized fibula, I use it as a barrel in ECRTs as a primary reconstruction along with the ECRT. Instead of putting in cement inside the canal, I sometimes use this vascularized fibula, and it has shown pretty good results. And also in younger children, in the tibia, we do TOF. That's as good as a vascularized fibula. And also in some cases in younger children, I have used vascularized fibula, which have reconstructed which actually remodeled and become as good as a tibia as they grew up.
Okay. So
this is in the weight-bearing areas. In the I use a lot of vascularized fibulas for the cases wherein we don't anticipate radiation as an adjuvant. In the upper limbs, I do use quite a few times.
Definitely. Can we have Dr. Pramod sir's opinion on vascularized fibula, please? Again, do you use it isolated, sir, or do you use it as a salvage procedure only? Hello. I can't hear you, sir. I think your mic is not connected. Hello.
Your mic is muted,
Doctor. I think your mic is muted, Doctor.
Yeah. Srimant.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you just try? Your voice also broke. Can you just repeat the question?
Sir. So the main thing is vascularized fibula, as Dr. Suman and Dr. Kishore also said, what's your experience in using it in as an isolated entity? Would you prefer using it in the upper limb, or do you always try to use it as an adjunct along with any recycled bone or as a salvage procedure only?
Wherever possible, I'll use it as an adjunct. I mean, as an along with an allograft or a recycled bone. In isolated also I've used in ulna and humerus.
Okay.
But I always would love the strength along with an adjuvant with an ECRT bone or a allograft. I mean that my opinion would be adjuvant. It always work well.
And do you prefer more in pediatric or adult patients, sir, the vascularized fibula procedures?
Of course, pediatric is a must for sure. I mean, even in up to adolescents also, I take it. And adults, I think, no, not many we have done. But yes, wherever possible, definitely, if you find that there is a need for an extra life and longer resections, I think it's worthwhile adding fibula. It's good.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Suman, for your talk and inputs from Dr. Kishore and Dr. Pramod. Now we'd like to invite Dr. Vishnu. So we're moving on to the interactive case discussion. I guess we're just a little bit tired on time. So Dr. Vishnu, you're around, please.
Can you allow me to please screen share?
Yes, Mrs. Debrina, can you just please allow Dr. Vishnu to share the screen, please? So he'll be taking us through a few interesting cases so that we can have our panelists, faculties, everybody try to get along and see how we touch upon them and manage them.
Yes, sir. Can go ahead with the sharing.
Srimant, you'll have to open in your Srimant. There's some problem.
Okay, let me just do that. Ms. Devlin, if you can just share the screening part with me.
Allow Dr. Srimant to screen share, please.
Sir, every panelist is allowed to share their screen. So
yeah, I'll do that now, please.
Okay.
Is the screen visible now?
No, Shriman.
Yeah. So, okay. Yeah, Dr. Vishnu, it's your chair now. Kindly go across, please show across your cases and it's going to be a good discussion involving all the panelists and the audience also, please.
Thank you. I would like to thank OASIS for giving me this opportunity to present a few interactive cases on treatment decisions in bone tumors. So the first set of cases will be for proximal tibial malignant tumors in children. Next slide. So this is our first patient, is a 10-year-old boy who was complaining of pain and swelling around the knee and the left upper leg for the past 3 months. And on examination, he had a 5x4 cm upper tibial metaphyseal swelling with a range of movement of 10 to 100 degrees. This is the X-ray of the patient. I would request Dr. Suman to please read this X-ray and give his inputs, please.
Vishnu, sorry, I just missed the age of the patient.
10 years, Suman.
Okay, fine, yeah. Okay, so Navneet beautifully explained his presentation, like how to go about and read an X-ray. So here is an aggressive-looking bone-forming lesion which is involving the epidia and metaphysis of the proximal tibia with a soft tissue component and a periosteal reaction, which is of a Codman's type. And zone of transition looks white to me. So it's a primarily aggressive bone forming tumor. So my first differential diagnosis is the osteosarcoma in this case.
That's a very good reading of the X-ray. Dr. Suman, can you please tell me what would you like to do next for this patient? So you feel it's an aggressive malignant tumor. What would be the next step in the evaluation of this patient?
Yes. So ideally, we should get a MRI, which completely involves the entire length of tibia, which showing a knee and ankle joint. Contrast MRI.
Yeah. So this is what was done for the patient. Dr. Srimant, would you like to comment on the MRI? And would you explain why is an MRI important in the evaluation of a bone tumor, especially in this case?
See, again, I would add on to what Dr. Navneet shared across over there. Probably he would have been the better person to answer across. So one is MR gives the extent of the tumor, the T1 weighted image, and the STIR also gives the extent and the involvement of the tumor along the length of the bone. Here, I think we missed having a full length. We've not had the coverage up till the distal part, but still a screening sequence with the T1 coronal suggestion and STIR is very, very important to find out a few metastases. An axial section will allow us to find out what is the soft tissue and the bone component, and also the delineation between the planes between the muscles and the neurovascular bundles. So here again, we can see that there's a pretty large tumor in the proximal component. I guess the quality is not that great on the presentation, but we do feel that the posterior tibial vessels seem to be converting to lesion.
Excellent. So the local site staging a contrast MRI is the modality of choice. It is to be done in all suspected bone tumors. The T1 images help us give an intramedullary extent of the tumor, and T2 axial sections delineates the soft tissue component and defines the relationship of the vessels to the tumor. It is mandatory to obtain full length MRI of the bone with a scale to avoid missing skip mets, which is present in 10% of the patients. So next come to Dr. Navneet. Dr. Navneet, now the radiographic evaluation is done. What is to be done next for this patient?
Yeah, so we need to confirm the diagnosis with the biopsy. Needle biopsy should be very well enough. And I think we would like to do the biopsy from the medial approach. The likely future incision is going to be medial. And probably from the proximal metaphyseal area, I think the sampling would be better. At least 3 cores of 1 centimeter each should be adequate, and all of it should be sending in the 10% formulae.
So this was our slides. If someone could help take it,
I think we'll have to chuck it. But there seems to be quite a bit of malignant osteo, you know, all these pink eosinophilic areas being seen here.
So this is confirmed to be a high grade osteosarcoma.
Yeah,
so basically, what next for this patient, sir? Would you, Dr. Pramod, would you give, what would you do next for this patient, sir? How do you stage your osteosarcomas? Would you stage, and what investigations would you use to stage, sir?
Of course, the PET CT, man. The PET CT for sure. I mean, if it's whatever is a metastatic or a non-metastatic, depending upon that, I mean, doesn't matter. The study was a neoadjuvant MAP regimen of chemotherapy. And at 10 years, definitely, if it's a non-metastatic, it should do well. That's my thought of PET-CT would be the best with F18, yeah.
Okay, especially in osteosarcoma, there is a lot of controversy on the investigation of choice for staging. So there is a lot of evidence currently coming in for an F18 FDG PET. And this is for a fluoride FDG PET. Next slide, please. So they have this is a study coming out in 2016 where they concluded that the CT chest is the most appropriate examination for the for pulmonary metastasis. And this patient compared a PET CT with bone scan, and they found out that the sensitivity and specificity rates for both PET and PET CT and bone scan is mentioned here. So as Dr. Pramod was telling, all patients after a diagnosis of osteosarcoma is established will receive neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Now there is a lot of controversy regarding neoadjuvant chemotherapy, whether 2 drug is to be used or 3 drug and IAP versus MAP. It's highly variable between institutions and depends on protocols. We normally use a 3 drug regimen, and we tend to use methotrexate-based chemotherapy or MAP chemotherapy. So after completion of chemotherapy, this patient presented to us with stable disease, and post-operative X-ray and MRI are to be done again after completion of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. In this particular patient, the response to chemotherapy was clinically as well as radiologically static. So my next question is to Dr. Srimant. Dr. Srimant, what would you like to do for this patient based upon the index MRI and X-ray findings? What surgery would you like to offer for this patient?
See, if I can just go back to the scans here. Yeah, so this is basically an involvement right from the epiphyseal area onto the diaphyseal area with a large volume tumor mass. And as I said, a non-metastatic at presentation with static response on chemotherapy. So being a 10-year-old, definitely I would like to keep the first option as considering the growth deficiency, which is going to be there.
at least probably nothing less than 6 to 7 centimeters across until his maturity, is a tumor process, a wide excision and a tumor process with an expandable option. The second option, which I would still keep, is a rotation plasty in this sort of a situation. So these are my two options, which I would look at. Probably you'll have to just check with other panelists also and find out things.
Dr. Suman, would you like to add your inputs on the management for this child?
So he is 10 year old. Yes. Ideally, we should go for an expandable proximal tibia replacement prosthesis. But as we know, good expandable prosthesis are very expensive. If patient is affordable, it's well and good. And 10 year old in this case, if patient is not affordable for an expandable prosthesis, I still would do a regular prosthesis and lengthen by 1 to 2 centimeter intraoperatively and then take a call. If patient is not financially fit for expandable prosthesis.
Can we just request Dr. Srinivas, sir, over there on his opinion on this case, please? Sir, you're online.
Normally, any limbs are, we give three or four options for any patient with the malignancy. One is arthroplasty. Second would be rotation plasty. Amputation is definitely also another option. When counseling, I think all the options have to be provided, and then the pros and cons of each procedure has to be explained to the patient. The patient is not metastatic. Like everybody said, expandable process is an option. Only thing is you have to see what is the amount of bone left behind down. We don't have the length. So all the planning has to be done. If there's a possibility to do a mega process with the expansion, that's the first preferred option. And of course, there are other methods of reconstruction. You can use rotation plasty or an arthrodesis with the vascularized fibula. Various options are there. This has to be discussed with the patient, and then a call has to be taken.
So I think one question I have to Dr. Kishore Reddy, sir. We had so many options being discussed about the surgical plan. So does the prognosis or the outcome of the patient on chemotherapy have a bearing on what type of surgery we do, sir, even though it is a non-metastatic patient? Yeah, is Dr. Kishore Reddy online? Okay, I think we're not able to reach him. Can I push this question to Dr. Pramod, sir? So does your surgery depend on what is the progress of the patient on chemotherapy?
Yes, I mean, definitely. I mean, if we find him as a long-term survivor, definitely I would be more biological in the beginning, then later go to the prosthesis.
How would you do a biological here, sir? Can you just please...
See, if it's a 10-year-old boy, right? So 10-year-old boy, this still femoral physis is still intact. Yes. So I would not damage that. Rather, I'll do a hemiarthroplasty kind of a picture here. Probably, you know, use many methods. I mean, there are so many methods you can use in APC, allograft prosthetics, or anyway, only the tibial thing on block, you remove it, reconstruct only the tibial side. Take him till 13, 14 years. Then I think probably you can end the surgery at 15th or 16th if need be. But sometimes they do so well. I mean, they can go on till 17. I have a child who's gone till 16, 17 with a little bit of a defect of length. Probably, if he's a long-term survivor, the effort is worth it.
Okay, so you would again say that you would like to do something like a staged procedure to make sure that you have the best outcome.
Not exactly staged. I would rather try to save the distal femoral physis.
But my question is like, what kind of reconstruction, what you use to connect the tibia to distal femur? Like what implant or how you are going to?
No implant. What we do is essentially when we remove it on block, the proximal tibia, and reconstruct either you do a pedicle liquid nitrogen or something, and you resurface the tibial platform using a regular joint replacement prosthesis, and make sure your capsule and the PCL, you take some good suture anchors to that, and do a purse string. And also proximal tibia needs a gastroc flap, medial gastroc flap. So all these things will make a nice wrap around the distal femur, around the joint. and they do pretty well. But it needs a bit for a lot of soft tissue reconstruction around the knee joint. No hardware into the femur. No hardware into the femur. Yeah, yeah.
Dr. Rajiv Reddy, do you have any other suggestions, or would you go along with what has been shared across?
Yes, I think I'll agree with the options. All the options that are possible, rotation plasticity, the processes as well as amputation should be discussed. My only point of view is when the patient doesn't have a great response to chemotherapy, then yes, we should sit down with the patient and counsel regarding both the amputation as well as limb salvage and explain all the pros and cons and leave it up to the patient to choose whether they actually want to go for limb salvage.
Okay. I think Dr. Vishnu will be able to share as to what it is. Dr. Vishnu, could you just let us know what happened? I'll be going.
So this patient had a static response to on chemotherapy, both in clinically as well as in the MRI. So this is what we did. We resected the tumor. We had to do an osteoarticular resection because it was going up to the joint line. And we put an expandable tumor prosthesis, which was custom made. And this is a second generation device, which is also known as the minimally invasive device. Next slide. So this basically consists of two, a threaded inner rod and an outer hollow component. And you can see the femoral component also. There's a locking screw which keeps everything in place. And we can just release the locking screw and turn the wedges down, which causes, which allows for expansion to happen. This was designed by us in and used very frequently in Cancer Institute in Adyar. Next slide. So, but the problem with any second generation device is failed lengthening. You can see that lengthening has happened and then it has collapsed.
Yes.
Subsequently, we had to use a wedge every time we expanded, and wedges were put like this so that adequate expansion could be got. And in this patient, we have got around 5 centimeters lengthening at the end of 4 years.
Okay. So,
just a similar scenario since we are discussing proximal tibia. So this is the pre-chemo image, X-ray image of a patient with a osteosarcoma of the proximal tibia.
Yeah. I think in view of time, you can just target the questions, probably the more pertinent questions, so we can get even Dr. Raju also to show these cases over there. So can I go to the next slide?
Next slide. So this was what happened during chemotherapy. So there was a collapse of the fracture site, and you can see that there's not much ossification. So Dr. Rajiv Reddy, what would you do for this patient? This patient is non-metastatic both at presentation as well as post chemotherapy. However, he started developing progressive varus deformity in his knee joint on treatment. And this is how his post chemotherapy X-ray looked like, with a healed pathological fracture.
He is non-metastatic and the limb looks salvageable. So we can't see the MRI, but...
Unfortunately, I don't have the MRI for this. But the vessels and nerve are free, sir.
Yes. We trust Dr. Vishnu that it's clear.
Yes, and he's aged 10 years, is it?
He's 10 years old.
Yes, I would suggest the same thing, sir. Expandable mega processes. He is non-metastatic. The limb is totally salvageable with a decent chemotherapy response. I would suggest an expandable proximal tibia mega processes with a medial gastroplasty.
Yes. So this mega processes is a workhorse for all orthopedic oncologists. But however, for this patient, there was a lot of affordability issues and the patient could not afford even this processes. So we ended up doing a rotation plasty. In the rotation plasty, we resect the tumor along with the portion of the femur. We separate the entire limb and base it only on its neurovascular pedicle. Next slide. And then so this is how it looks. The limb is hanging only on its neural and vascular pedicle. Then we rotate it 180 degrees and reattach the tibia to the femur such that the ankle joint will now behave like a knee joint. And this was what surgery was done for this patient. The advantage that rotation plasty offers is much better functional outcomes compared to above knee amputation, which has also been shared by the previous speakers.
Dr. Vishnu, I have one question. Why, considering that there was a small collapse progressive, there's a fracture line which was seen basically because of the increased lytic component over chemo. So why wasn't just an osteoarticular resection done and maybe a nail plate cement spacer used for this type?
So this patient, was non-metastatic. So we still wanted to give him the best. We are assuming that his survivorship is going to be good. When you put a nail cement spacer, we should understand that it is always a temporary device or a temporary solution. Plus, since this is an osteoarticular resection, we would have had to arthrodesis knee joint. which is often not accepted by especially Indian patients. So this patient was offered amputation or rotation plasty, and he actually opted for rotation plasty, which was what was done for him.
So what was the percentage necrosis in this case?
Only 60%, Dr. Navneet.
That's something which is not in our hands, but looking at the way the...
But you can see 6 years post-op, Navneet, he still survived.
No.
Any inputs from Dr. Srinivas or Dr. Pramod on this case, sir?
I mean, good job. Good job. Vishnu, what was the chemo given? MAP? Yeah?
No, sir. This was IAP, sir, because it was old.
Old means a 10-year boy, right?
Sir, no, sir. This patient was seen 6 years ago. So, at that time, we were giving IAP, sir. Three drugs, but we were giving...
Okay. Anyway, I mean, it's a good job. I mean...
Any inputs, Dr. Suman?
We know that rotation plastic gives excellent functional outcome. Only thing is patient should understand it and ready to take that little cosmetic deformity which comes. Otherwise, it's an excellent procedure.
Yeah, so acceptance is a big issue, right? The social fabric in our society does not allow everyone to go for this, but it's a really wonderful procedure. Especially any child sub 8 years, I think that would be the best surgery of choice, I guess, probably.
I think Dr. Srinivas also will know there is a patient in TMH post-rotation plasty. He is a Paralympic javelin participant. So he represents India now. So that's our outcome, what we get with rotation plasty.
Yeah,
I just want to add something. Sometimes I prefer rotation plasty over expandable megaprocesses for children.
Yes, sir.
The trouble that patients will go through with multiple expansions and then the revisions and infection is a lot. This is one surgery which will give him a solution for lifelong. And all that he has to do is manage his processes, and below knee processes generally do extremely well. They can do everything possible. And they don't have to worry about coming back to hospital, don't have to worry about multiple surgeries. So psychologically also, over a period of time, I think this is one of the best options that we have today.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Vishnu, any other case or do we jump?
We have a benign tumor, Dr. Srimant. If we have time, I'll go ahead with that also.
Bharat sir, I think we should be able to stretch it by another 10 minutes or so.
Yeah, that should be fine.
Okay. Yeah, I think we'll go with the next one.
Next patient is a 11-year-old girl who was complaining of pain over the right hip with difficulty in walking for the past 2 months, and she had increased severity of pain with inability to bear weight for the past 2 weeks. Next slide. She was unable to bear weight and she was wheelchair bound with a VAS score of 8/10. There was no palpable mass but marked tenderness over the anterior hip joint line. So this is the x-ray of the patient. Dr. Navneet, would you like to comment on this x-ray?
I think probably we'll have to help everyone with an MRI also.
I am not able to see anything.
Yeah, as I wish to have seen something, so we'll have to, I guess probably. Oh, you put a CT scan, okay. Dr. Navneet?
If Dr. Rajiv Reddy is there also.
Dr. Rajiv, if you could just jump in.
Yeah, on the CT scan, I can see that there is a lytic lesion in the right supraacetabular area as well as in the right ileum, and it looks fairly well defined. There's a lot of edema on the MRI surrounding the lesion in the supraacetabular area.
Okay.
Go back to the X-ray, Sriman.
Yeah.
Can we spot a lytic lesion in the acetabulum now? Now that we are wiser with the CT scan and the MRI.
The amount of soft tissue shadow in the abdomen, I guess. I think it's going to be a pretty difficult job. Maybe we can, that could even mask a gas shadow also, please.
I can see only bladder and bowels.
Yeah, that's it. I don't think we can see anything else. So
there's a message for everybody. A threshold to do CT scans and MRIs is coming down, and it is well justified. It's better to overdo then miss out these lesions and subject the patient to large tumors. I think there's nothing wrong. I think there's an older teaching that, you know, we assess clinically and x-ray and observe and then ask the patient to come back again and then repeat the investigations. So I think we should be a little bit careful here. I think my threshold over a period of time has come down to investigate these patients with
Sir, I have a question.
Very true.
Yeah, I think for you and Dr. Pramod also. So this picture looks something, pretty, I guess, intermediate aggressiveness. So I still feel infection should be something which should be kept in mind. So would you suggest an MRI contrast whenever you do an MRI, suggest for a patient, or just a plain MRI is all what you would suggest for these cases?
I think as a routine, MRI with contrast should be done because you don't know what you're dealing with and you can't ask the patient to go back and do another MRI. I think as a protocol, you should just ask the patient to get a contrast MRI.
Yeah, but a CT is not required in every case, right? So if they do a complementary limited one, it would definitely help. But unless we are thinking of an osteoma, I don't think a CT exposure to radiation for a child is most of the times.
Routinely not required, yeah.
MRI would give the sufficient picture. So, Dr. Vishnu, yours again, please. So, I think I would still keep something intermediate or infection as a differential. Anybody else would like
for me, to? Me, infection, LCH.
LCH.
LCH is as well. Because age group, location, and a lot of edema. Yes.
So, basically, disproportionate edema is something which we are always worried about, right?
So, this is very key word. Disproportionate edema is seen only in a few bone tumors. One of them is LCH and one of them is chondroblastoma. In these conditions, you get disproportionate edema, and that should also give a clue. So, if anybody has anything else to say, the next step for this patient would confirm be a biopsy, correct?
Yes. Yes.
Any blood tests which we can do for this child? Does it help?
So only routine blood tests were advised at this point of time. ESR was within normal limits, and so was CRP.
CRP quantitative also, just to rule out the same. So can I go to the next slide, Dr. Vishnu?
Yeah. So in this patient, because there is no palpable mass and the tumor is completely intraosseous with lots of edema, we had to do a targeted biopsy for this patient. Next slide. Now, before this patient presented to us, they also had a PET scan which showed that it was a solitary site of uptake. Next slide.
Okay, again, that gives us more clue as to whether it's an infection versus an infection.
So, the biopsy for this patient was had come as a solitary LCH or an eosinophilic granuloma. So, previous slide. So, what would be the ideal treatment for this LCH? Dr. Suman?
Now, if it's a solitary lesion, most of the times they heal after biopsy. So, whatever the trauma and the inflammation set in, so most of the solitary lesions heal. So, I like to observe in this case and wait for 6 to 8 weeks, then see how patient responds and then take a call.
I have a question, Dr. Vishnu. I think to all the faculty, intralesional steroid at the time of biopsy, when we know that we're likely dealing with an eosinophilic granuloma.
Well, I wouldn't like to give intralesional steroid randomly for all patients without a biopsy, especially
it can be our
DD. Anything. It could be infection also.
Yes, our second DD was infection, so better I would avoid steroid in this case.
And it's a child, generally, you know, steroid, even if you know it's LCH or a eosinophilic granuloma, they tend to heal very well. So you can wait a bit before you think of steroid.
Any systemic therapy, Dr. Vishnu, for this patient?
No. So, because it is solitary LCH, there is no role of any systemic therapy. A PET scan should be done for all patients with LCH because they tend to have multifocal disease, including diseases involving only lymph node and things like that. So, definitely a PET CT should be done. If the patient has systemic disease only then or multi-site disease only then he's a candidate for systemic therapy.
So, I think you already shared a bit of the literature about total remission.
Yeah. So, what is the importance of bringing to light this case is that there are certain bone tumors where less is very good. One of them is LCH and the other is a aneurysmal bone cyst where we have got the concept of curopsy. Dr. Rajiv, can you just enlighten us about curopsy and what are the principles of a curopsy? What exactly is a curopsy?
Yeah, so when we see a lesion in a young child, and on an X-ray, it's looking like a lytic lesion. And when we get a contrast MRI, which is showing that the lesion has peripheral enhancement, which is suggestive of a primary cystic lesion, then we can do something called as a curopsy, which is a combination of a curettage as well as a biopsy in the same setting. So that especially in a simple bone cyst, the biopsy material, which we take the scraping of the wall of the lesion, as well as doing the procedure itself, and sometimes injecting a steroid injection at the same time will help in healing of the cyst in the majority of the cases. so that we don't need to go back again and perform a surgery, or there's no need to do curettage again. What is important is that we have to counsel the patient that this may not work in about 30% of the patients, and they may need surgery later on if it's a non-healing cyst. And also the fact that we have to confirm that this is a cyst, there should be peripheral enhancement on MRI, and it should look that way before we do the procedure.
Excellent, Dr. Rajiv. Basically, it's a percutaneous procedure where we use the same Jamshedi needle, which we use to take the biopsy, but we insert the needle and scrape the entire wall of the cystic cavity under image guidance. So that we get appropriate material for sending for histopathology, as well as scraping of the cyst cavity causes the cyst to heal.
I think you have shared a few of the review of literature as to where we should not touch. One of those touch me not regions where just the biopsy itself would heal. I think we have quite a bit of details available. This is a pretty old one which says that RT should be given, but again, right now
current concept is to do a cure, like Suman rightly told, the current concept for in the treatment of LCH is first to do a curopsy.
Yes.
If the symptoms are not subsiding, you wait for a week or two and then you can inject intralesional steroid.
Yeah, most of it's observation versus steroid, and rarely we operate unless it's a pathological fracture. That's how we would look at. Role of radiotherapy again is pretty limited, because again it's anecdotal. Not every case gets radiotherapy until it's a multi-systemic involvement is what we look at, or it's a pretty heavy burden. Right. Yeah. So the same thing is what you've put across over there. So I think there's quite a lot of I would be jumping across. So in
LCH particularly, there are a lot of treatment options, and the treatment of the patient should be tailored to his needs. So what we usually do is masterly inactivity. If it's not working out, then intralesional steroids. And if it's not working out, then we attempt RFA or surgery for these patients. Next. So this is what we did. We did a steroid injection, and you can see excellent bone healing at 6 months and 9 months.
Yeah, so the only problem is that we did not find the lesion in the biopsy x-ray. So I think we'll have to take this bit of some subtle sclerosis over there as well. But the patient is asymptomatic, if I'm right. That is the most important indicator, right?
Yes. So usually following the curopsy, the patient will tell complete pain relief, usually within the first 3 or 4 days itself.
Yeah, that's another indicator. So it's a pretty good case to see and find out over there, when that we need to have differentials for aggressive tumors such as LCH and infection. I think that would work out. Probably, I think because of time constraint, Dr. Vishnu, can we ask Dr. Rajiv? Sure,
please go ahead. It was a real pleasure presenting my cases here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I think I'll just stop the screen sharing here, and I'll request Dr. Rajiv to please share his screen, so that we can go on to the next component of case discussion. Dr. Rajiv?
Yes. Is my screen visible?
Yes, please.
Yes, so thank you to the OSS office bearers, as well as the Karnataka Orthopedic Association, and Dr. Srimant, as well as Dr. Suman, for inviting me to this interaction. I'll begin with a 60-year-old gentleman who came with us with swelling in the thigh, in the right thigh, proximally and in the mid part. And he had this swelling since 6 months spontaneously, and it was increasing in size. He was also a diabetic and on clopidogrel. We went ahead and got an MRI with a contrast done, and Dr. Suman can help us with the MR images.
Can you show me the axial also, because except so there is a lesion with a mixed hyper and also hypo intensity, which is on the posterior to the vessel. Do you have
there's something called as a tail sign here, Dr. Rajiv, right?
Yes. So this part you can see this going. Yeah. Yes. So looks like it's sarcoma, and usually with soft tissue sarcoma, we won't be able to tell exactly what is it, but it's quite a big lesion, more than 5 centimeter deep to the muscle. So I would love to biopsy and then take a call.
Just that, I think it's pretty close to the sciatic nerve is what I feel, because I believe the fascia, I think it's pretty bit of the edema which is around the sciatic nerve.
Right. So yes, so we did get this MRA with the contrast done, and I would like to ask the panel as to what would be the next step. Should we go ahead with a surgery that is a wide excision, or should we do a biopsy? And if you do a biopsy, should it be an image-guided biopsy, because this looks like a big lesion which is superficial, and should it be a closed or open biopsy, or should we get a PET CT scan because this is looking malignant on the MRA scan anyway?
I think I did my talk, so I'll take that onus of that. So what I would suggest here is that we should definitely do a biopsy, that is a true cut biopsy, under an ultrasound guidance, or if required, even a CT guidance can also be used based on the facilities which are available. So that can be done in local anesthesia itself, and it should give us quite a bit of tissue. No intervention before getting a biopsy, please.
Yes, so we went ahead and got an ultrasound guided biopsy, and discussed in the talk by Dr. Srimant, and immunohistochemistry test was also done, and it was reported as a high grade pleomorphic sarcoma. And following the confirmation that this is a high grade sarcoma, we went ahead and got a PET CT scan done, and the PET CT showed that he had only this lesion, and there was no metastasis, and this was a highly active lesion with an SUV max of 24. So what do we do from here on? A high grade soft tissue sarcoma in a 60-year-old gentleman in the medial thigh, which is not metastatic. If Dr. Srinivasa can help us as to what should be the next step in actually treating this patient now.
Yeah, I think we should read the MRA properly and see, make sure that the neurovascular bundle is not involved. If there is a possibility of neurovascular involvement, like the sciatic nerve, I think we should be prepared for it. A wide excision is suggested for this case. And whether we add brachytherapy or not is something that we can take a call. We can have brachytherapy wires inserted post-excision. And if the sciatic nerve is involved, I think we should be prepared to excise the tumor from the sciatic nerve with various techniques.
Yeah.
As Dr. Srinivas mentioned, I would love to see the MRI complete pictures and see the relation of sciatic nerve. If sciatic nerve is very close, I would love to give a pre-op RT, right. So that will may help to reduce the size and also to sterilize the margin. And even the sciatic nerve, if it's involved, I would love to give a pre-op RT, because if we are resecting the nerve and doing the reconstruction, I don't want to add post-op RT. So these are my things. So based on the relation of sciatic nerve, I'm going to take a call. If I feel sciatic nerve is far away, they can get a good margin, upfront resection with RT. If it's very close or involved, RT followed by surgery.
The sciatic nerve is very close. Right? It was quite close on the other sequences which were lower down. It was not encased by the tumor, but it was quite close to the sarcoma.
Dr. Rajiv, I have one more point here. The tail scan is a very important prognostic factor for the patient in the local relapse also. I can see it is a pretty nice tail sign over here. Whenever we see these sort of lesions over there, I feel it's better to get a sterile margin beforehand so that you can go wider. Okay. Right. Some institutions do use chemotherapy in such cases. So I don't know what's the role is extremely limited. I don't think we use it much in India right here in certain situations. I don't think our panelists use also. I think Dr. Pramod, we can say, Dr. Pramod, sir, do you use or do you recommend neoadjuvant chemotherapy in such a case, considering that it's pretty close to the vital structure? There's a tail sign, which is again a poor prognosticator. Would you use that or would you use a pre-op RT?
No, definitely neoadjuvant, whatever. Definitely chemotherapy, I would try IFOS drugs, one or two cycles. My gut feeling is that it is going to work and it's going to give a nice, you know, capsular, in case makes the tissue, tumor more firmer. One or two cycles probably. And also think of
So the Pramod sir, I'm a little worried about the age. He's 60 and diabetic.
What is his age?
60. He's a diabetic he's on clopidogrel with the cardiac comorbidities already. So
giving Gadria will.
Yeah,
be...
I mean, yeah, that's the. I mean, I'm not too sure about how the general conditions. I agree with your comment. Totally agree with your comment. But definitely, as a new adjuvant RT also, as Suman was mentioning. I would rather, but it has to be planned well. It has to be planned well by you should sit with the radiation oncologist and plan it. Otherwise, you know, they just blast that area and you'll never be able to operate. Yeah, you should use a good machine and probably you should plan it well. I think it's going to do well with that.
Dr. Rajan,
that's my thought. I would definitely give a chemo and RT before.
Yeah, so what we did was the tumor board decided that we will first give him pre-op radiation, and following the pre-op radiation, we went ahead with the surgery. And as we had discussed here, the sciatic nerve was very close to the tumor at one particular area. It was free more or less proximally and distally, but at one junction, it was quite close. And once I resected the tumor and the sciatic nerve was free, I did send frozen margins, frozen section from the sheath over the sciatic nerve. And the sheath over the sciatic nerve and the resected sheath, the epineurium was resected once the tumor was out. Both were sent for frozen and they were reported as free of tumor. The margins were very close at some points, but the margins were overall free. And this was after radiation.
Okay.
So anything differently that would have been done?
I believe giving radiation preoperatively would have helped this patient because, you know, considering he's a diabetic and a 60-year-old, the choice of pre-op RT is probably beneficial for him because the complications would be much more in the post-operative phase, considering that the volume or the defect would be much larger to take care of. So I believe it's probably well done. And as I said, the margin, even though it's narrow, it's because of the anatomical constraints that you've got this margin, which I would say keep this patient as a high risk for relapse and monitor him at least for the next 4 to 5 years.
Right.
What's the wound? How is the wound healing, Rajiv?
The wound did heal well, sir, surprisingly, because it's in the medial thigh and he was diabetic. So surprisingly, because he's a thin guy, didn't have that much fat. But otherwise, he was at high risk for wound healing problems.
Okay. Think of a bazopinib tablet post-op. I mean, if you're not giving at least a 200 milligram to 400 milligram bazopinib tablet,
right.
Think of it to prevent any, you know, I mean, as we have registered a trial on that. We feel that, you know, some patients who do not have any disease, we feel that we have, it's got good response on that. Just think of it with the tumor board discussion and
right. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Rajiv, I think we've got time for one more case.
Yes, sir.
I think you would like to go for this, or is there any other case?
There is a metastatic case, sir, but
could just have a look at that, please, sir, just to have an idea about how we try to take it forward. Sorry, I think because of time constraint, we're a bit.
This is a 72-year-old gentleman who presented to us with pain in the left hip. And he had this pain since the past 3 months, but nothing was done about it. And this is the X-ray. And Navneet can help us with reading the X-ray.
Navneet, you are on mute. Sorry. Yeah. So the plain X-ray pelvis is both hips and proximal one-third femurs. Shows a large lytic lesion involving the superior ramus going up to the acetabulum with the soft tissue component and breach of the cortex at multiple places. And there is no matrix as such. But considering the age and a flat bone, likely to be a metastatic, I think. Metastatic is the first thing.
Right. So we went ahead and got a CT scan as well as an MRI scan. The CT scan showed that the entire anterior as well as the posterior columns to a large extent were destroyed by this lytic lesion. It was an aggressive looking lesion. And even on the MRI, we could make out that this had a huge soft tissue component and it had destroyed the bone.
Dr. Rajiv, I'll just button over here. Dr. Vishnu, you're around? I think I'm not getting it. Okay. Dr. Suman, 72-year-old male, just try to rush things up over there. Would you do a PET scan first or would you do an MRI or a CT first?
I always do PET first and see, is there any multiple lesions, and then plan a biopsy according to that.
Okay, so there's no harm in doing this, but since we have the facility in a center, if there is an option in a 72-year-old pain patient, secondaries would be the first thing we would look at. Primary, again, comes as a third one.
See, on the X-ray, if it has a characteristic feature of a primary, then I will work up like a primary with an MRI. Otherwise, I get a PET. Yes, it's not wrong to get an MRI and work up. It depends on person to person.
So my next question is, why would you get a PET? Are you planning to biopsy somewhere else?
See, the mainly actually, this is a quite a big lesion, but if it's a mass in the liver or big lesion in the lung, it is easy to biopsy and it is easy to do a IHC on those specimen than doing a bone biopsy. So it is get an idea that which is what is the primary and you can plan your biopsy according to that.
Dr. Rajiv, to you please. Yes.
So that was a discussion. Should we get a PET CT scan first or biopsy first, or should we directly start the treatment? And we did go ahead and after the MRA was done, we got a biopsy first. And so in some cases, we can go ahead and do a PET CT because this was looking like an aggressive metastatic lesion. And the biopsy was reported as a metastatic clear cell renal cell carcinoma. So from we've now come to a diagnosis that this is a metastatic lesion. So we got a PET CT scan done, and the FDG PET showed lesions not only in the pelvic hip joint and proximal thigh region, but it also showed the primary, which is the kidney. And the neuro-oncologist who was then involved in the case felt that since this lesion is now involving the abdominal IVC and it is not resectable, and it will not be possible to go ahead with surgery to get an excision of the tumor in the kidney. So at this point, when we know that the primary is not curable and he doesn't have any other metastatic lesion except the primary and in the pelvis, so what should be our next step? Should we go ahead and give him chemotherapy, or should we give a definitive radiation therapy to the pelvis, or should we go ahead and operate and resect or curate the pelvic lesion?
Dr. Srinivasa.
Quite a large pelvic lesion. Is there any other lesions are there?
No, sir. The primary is renal, the kidney, and only the pelvis and proximal thigh.
Yeah, so basically it's a very large pelvic lesion. Curating that would be like a disaster. It'll bleed. It'll bleed to death.
Yes.
So I think angioembolization and radiotherapy should be looked into for local therapy. And the kidney part, obviously the tumor board, we can discuss with the urologist and decide what to do with the primary. Once the in smaller lesions, we can go ahead and excise it. But if this lesion responds to angioembolization and radiotherapy, we can plan some kind of a reconstructive surgery for the hip going forward. But these surgeries are quite morbid, especially in a 72-year-old. We should be extremely careful what you want to do with the pelvic lesion. Smaller lesions, altered lesions, be aggressive. You can attempt excision, and these people generally tend to do well. If you remove the primary and the solitary metastasis, the overall survival is good for these patients.
Right.
Dr. Pramod, your opinion, would you again go with a bit of a conservative management, or would you try to do something to stabilize the hip, knowing that it's vascular?
Yeah, I mean, it's a super case. But if there are only two lesions, one, the kidney and the pelvis, right?
Yes,
so I think it's still worth it to consider. See, here, renal cell carcinoma, no radiotherapy, no chemotherapy will work. We know that. It's a radio-resistant and chemo-resistant tumors. So what we have to do is probably removal of the primary tumor has to be considered, one. And number two, a girdle stone arthroplasty would definitely help in the pain management, two. After the embolization, as Dr. Srinivas said, he's going to bleed if you are going to go anywhere near that without any precautions. Do an embolization, plan for a girdle stone, remove the primary, because renal cell carcinoma, they are not going to die so early. So they are going to live for quite some time. And that too with only one met, think of primary removal of the kidney. And that also has got a delayed effect on the regression of the disease elsewhere. So hence, removal of the kidney, a girdle stone, and probably pazopanib, Votrient tablet. That is also Sutent, the sunitinib tablets, which they give it after the resection of the renal cell carcinoma, would definitely make his life better for the next, at least, if I'm not wrong, 4-5 years, it should be all right. That's my thought, Rajiv.
So, Dr. Yes. Rajiv, what did you do for this patient?
Yes, the uro-oncologist here felt that the primary cannot be removed. It's inoperable. So, that's the reason why we didn't do any radical treatment for the pelvic lesion, and we went ahead with radiation therapy only. Okay. And he's just about to complete his radiation, but from what we can see, he has responded decently well. His pain has decreased, and he's able to walk with support.
Okay.
With the protrusion acetabulum?
Yes, with support. He needs a walker. He's not able to put weight on that.
He'll have a lot of pain.
The pain is much better than before. So when he had come, he was on a stretcher and he was absolutely restless. Yeah.
But he's Think of doing a girdle stone in the future. Yes. I mean, at least once everything is all right.
Right.
Just gently, be gentle. Don't disturb the bed. And I think it's going to give a lot much quality of life.
Right.
Yeah. One of the things you can do is you can just excise the head and neck pontus tumor.
There
won't be a load transfer over there, so yeah. I think that should also help him out. So I guess that's it for the day, I guess. So can we wind up the session? So, Dr. Rajiv?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rajiv, for sharing your cases.
Thank you.
Dr. Suman, I'd like you to just give a vote of thanks to all the faculties and all involved in the meeting, please.
Thank you, Srimant. I really like to thank Srinivas sir, Pramod sir, Kishore sir, my dear friends Rajiv, Navneet and Vishnu for attending this conference with CME and making it very interesting. And we had an excellent discussion over 2.5 hours. And I really like to thank, we had, I think, more than 50 registrations that on a weekday. So that was quite nice to see for an onco session. And I like to thank OSS office bearer, Dr. Silvaraj sir, Dr. Anand K. Kutti sir, Nityananda sir, Chandrasekhar sir, and Bharat sir for giving this opportunity and sharing our work and experience with others. Thank you so much.
Thank you once again, sir. Bharat sir.
Let's wind up. Thank you all once again.
And we should thank the attendees also who've been patient enough. I guess the number started dwindling down in the last half an hour.
Yeah.
But even on a weekday, we had 50. That's a good number, actually.
Yeah.
So we started off with around 70, I think.
Okay. Oh, fantastic. Otherwise, so much, we end up discussing ourselves, me, Srinivas, Srimad Vishnu. So this was a fantastic platform. We had a lot of people. So
it was a good interaction.
Yes. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay. So thank you to all the faculty. I think some of them exited before because of time constraint. Let's hope to meet up sometime again.
Thank you, Suman.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it was great. Good organizing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Thank you, Anil, sir.
Good night, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, Debalena. Good night. For providing the platform.
Stop recording, please. Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. Thank you, Srinivas. Thank you, Suman. Srimant.
Recording stopped. Bye-bye.